Wolfpack, huh? Well, I do not do CED. I do not do full screen or any variations of that particular bent. No VHS either. I will not stretch my image, no panning or scanning, absolutely no opening of the mat. I get 200 discs a day, and I do not spin without a contract. Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Laserdisc Wolfpack THX CAV Special Limited Edition Podcast. And it's a special one again. We're doing a director's special. I'm going to tell you more about that very shortly. I am your host, Sam Culture Dog Hatch, and I'm about to pass it on to the man who suffers psychotic breaks and turns into his alter ego, Hulk Van Dudikoff, whenever he has an encounter with a romantic comedy from the 30s. That's Ryan Cushing.
Thank you, brother. Tonight's podcast is brought to you by Double Dry Hopped, Double India Pale Ale, main course. With that, I'll pass it off to Seth Peterson.
Hello, everyone. I am the Norwegian grandfather. No, I'm not. it's great to be here. So I picked the topic for this podcast. I suggested Brian De Palma, and now I'm here. And it's great to be. It's in the middle of the night. It's 2 a.m. or something. And I am hopped up on Red Bull and sugar. So, yeah. Over to the Pacific and Maxine.
Working so hard to be somebody special, just working hard to survive. Well, you're special to me, babe, but what I can't see, babe, is where they go when they arrive. Where do all the discs go when they arrive? Maxine, Laserdisc Queen, coming at you from sunny Southern California. And I'm here in the paradise, if you can't tell.
Well, you should be. And if you're at home watching this and wondering, I mean, you probably looked at the thumbnail. You know what the heck we're talking about already. But, I mean, we've done, what, Robin Williams. We've done Michael Keaton films.
Nicolas Cage.
Nicolas Cage, Cage Match. We did a John Carpenter festival and maybe a couple others. But obviously, we're going to do Steven Spielberg. No, wait. We're going to do a friend of Steven Spielberg, Brian De Palma. And this would be the perfect episode for Vinny to show up. I mean, because he's like kind of Scorsese-ish. Mm-hmm. I mean, he found Robert De Niro before Scorsese stole him.
Yeah.
Thieving bastard. But Vinny's like hanging out with friends. I don't know. It's just the four of us. So you're going to have a nice, quick, fun night talking De Palma.
Yeah.
My mom is not a fan of De Palma. So she gave this video a thumbs down.
Neither is my mom.
It's the thumbs moms. Down away.
Two moms do not approve of De Palma.
Grandma also thumbs down it.
We talked Sorry, about Grandma. This over Easter dinner, and she's like, oh, De Palma. It didn't go over well. I'm like, but Ma, you know, Mission Impossible is cool, right? Yeah. Oh, maybe he's got a couple good ones. Yeah. Anyways. But yeah, for you, those out there who've never heard of Brian De Palma, he was part of the new Hollywood. Like, it's weird to think, like, he was part of the group of, you know, Lucas and Scorsese and, you know, Paul Schrader, John Milius and Spielberg. He was like good buds with Spielberg. So, I mean, I guess he was a contender, but maybe he's not as popular as Spielberg in most people's eyes. But yeah, he was born September 11th, very portentous day in 1940. And went on to make a lot of psychological thrillers and then commercial hits when he doesn't make psychological thrillers. Sometimes those payoffs, most of the time they don't. And a lot of, work for hire type stuff that I ended up liking. But we'll talk more about that later. He's known for a lot of special techniques, including Dutch angles and split screen stuff he does all the time, and his split focus diopter thing he does. He's known for ripping off Hitchcock and ripping off people that ripped off Hitchcock and ripping off people who like Hitchcock. And yeah, long tracking shots and things like that. So
I call them,
you're going to get into it.
De Palmisms.
Yeah, De Palmisms. Get ready. So we're going to go chronologically as we do. And if it's got a Laserdisc, we're going to show it. And if we don't own it, I'll do my best to drop in some overlays of, you know, Japanese pressings and stuff like that. As far as I know, the first thing that's on LD, because he did a short film called Murder a la Mod, which is 16 millimeter about models being murdered. I don't think that's on like a shorts box set or anything, but he was the guy that found De Niro and put him in three movies before Scorsese, including 1968's Greetings, which Ryan has.
Wow.
I mean, way to make a 60s film look like an 80s comedy.
Wild slapdash humor. It's hilarious.
You showed up again?
Yeah, is that what you said, or is that what it says on the jacket?
That's obviously what it says on the jacket.
Did you watch it?
It was painful. It had like a really bad jingle and it felt really dated, and that was it. But it does have a gem inside if you actually find this in the thrift store for less than $5. Got a nice giant insert.
Oh, look, Max has got it.
So this is the real gem of the movie, not the movie.
All right. I mean, what's about three friends skipping out on Vietnam? And,
yep.
And Robert De Niro is one of them.
It's very dated comedy that doesn't play well now.
Yeah, supposedly it was one of the first, if not the first film, given an X rating, but then they changed their mind.
Yeah, it's rated R here, so I don't know if this is cut or they just re-rated it.
Yeah,
maybe it must have been re-rated because the R rating came out like 1980s or something. When did that come out, Sam?
Maybe right before the home video release.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah, that might not have been the original theatrical. Yeah, but it's, I don't know. I have to check that out. Cool. We have to do a deep dive. Maybe I'll put a text overlay some of the information.
Just skip it. You got options.
Yeah. So then De Niro came back a year later playing the same character in a movie called The Wedding Party, which I don't think is on LD, right?
Nope.
It's on Arrow Video box set with that film. And the next film, Hi Mom, with De Niro, again, but not on Laserdisc. And there was also a documentary called Dionysus in 69. Then 72, he did Get to Know Your Rabbit with Tom Smothers, which, no LD?
No.
All right. So we're off to a bad start.
Criterion really missed the boat with their 3 by De Palma release.
Uh-huh. And I mean, that movie's a tap dancing magician movie. They really should have put that out. But anyways, 72, he came out with Sisters. And I love the face because it looks like he's looking at a face like this. I'm going to kill you. I don't know. It's just, I like the face. Anyways, I actually like this film. I think it's a lot of fun. But he also, you know, he was doing a lot of Hitchcock nods in this film.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Because it was low budget, I don't know, they didn't really bother me as much as when he's doing this big slick Hollywood Hitchcock ripoffs.
Did this one have Bernard Herrmann as the composer, or was that another one?
Yes.
Yeah, this one, and we'll hear more about him later. So yeah, that was like audacious of him to even say, oh, I'm just going to take, you know, the composer of, you know, so many Hitchcock classics and have him make my cheap, yeah, low budget, you know, thriller film. So yeah, Margot Kidder plays this Canadian model who is on some sort of like candid camera type television show where she's, you know, getting some guy to look at her boobs when she walks into her room, and they're going to decide if he's going to keep staring when she like undresses. And so after that, she ends up going out for dinner with that guy. And there's some other dude at the restaurant who seems to, at the African room, who seems to think that they're married or were married, and it gets weirder from there. And they go back to her place and shenanigans ensue. Apparently there may or may not be another one of her out there somewhere, and it gets pretty wild.
And a couch slash
yeah. There's I gotta say, the couch thing, that was a pretty good solution. I was like, oh yeah. Damn,
that sequence was pretty great.
That's good thinking. And like right off the bat, there's a huge part of this movie that's got the split screen where there's
It's pretty cool. He does it really well in this one. Yeah, it's like he uses
the window sequence.
Yeah, and you've got like all the stuff going on because you've got a neighbor who's viewing a potential murder, Jennifer Salt playing the neighbor, and then you've got her calling the cops. You've got the cops and her like arriving at this high rise, waiting to get up to this apartment where there's this guy who's trying to cover up what's gone on in this apartment, and you're like, what the hell? And so yeah, this split right down the middle, and you're like watching both scenes. It's like the elevator's going up while the guy's like hiding in the hallway. Pretty clever. So
decent transfer too.
Not bad, right? It is letterboxed randomly because there's some bits, like especially with the split screen, where they just go to letterboxing and then they go back to pan and scan or 4:3 after that. But not too shabby, right?
It's like an 86 Japanese pressing or something. Like it's early. So
yeah. And I think there's a PAL one from the UK, maybe, but screw that.
Does it matter?
Yeah, no. Who cares about I
we got Obi Strip.
Yeah.
So was there anything else that was fun about the actor, the guy that plays the husband sort of guy, we see more of him.
Yes, we do. He's gonna show up shortly. Have you seen this, Max? Check it out.
It's a good one. Like it's
good.
Yeah. It's up there. And surprisingly for it being as cheap of production, it doesn't show it. Like it's very well edited and filmed.
It's got a pretty cool ending shot. Kind of cool twist. And it's got a bunch shot in 16mm during this big trip dream sequence. So super grainy and interesting stuff. Yeah. So, I mean, I could see why everyone was asked when this came out, because I would have been like, oh, this guy's, an up-and-coming film superstar. Sadly, in the next film, I don't think I have on LD. Aww. Do I have it on something else? I think I have a Blu-ray maybe, but Ryan's got it. Whoa. I mean, you're gonna want to make a musical after like a rock musical with Paul Williams right after you make a Hitchcock thriller. Oh. Makes sense to me.
This movie is legendary. It was before Rocky Horror. It crushed Rocky Horror, in my opinion.
I mean, this was a huge part of my childhood because it was on UHF TV like a lot back in the day, and like I knew my dad was into it, and so I'm like, oh, I gotta check this out. Cool. Yeah,
it's campy, it's enjoyable, like everything.
You can see where I feel like Rocky Horror even took certain things from this, that the blonde Adonis, the like maid outfits, like there's so many just little intricacies that are just like totally nabbed. And this is just like the music in this is just like incredible. You could listen to this, like it's all freaking great music.
Yeah, so you go from Bernard Herrmann to freaking Paul Williams, man. And Jessica Harper from Suspiria is in it, and
that's where I knew you were from. I couldn't
and he's the same actor that played the ex-husband in Sisters. So definitely great. How's the LD? Is it decent?
I mean, mine was clean. It wasn't rotted or anything. Decent,
It's an 80s CBS Fox. Like, it's not going to win any awards for LD quality, but it's not terrible. I didn't have, like, huge dropouts or rot or anything, which I was worried because, it's right in that era. But, no, it was okay. I haven't seen the Japanese one, but it's got
There's two, right? Japanese?
There's two different pressings.
I'll put those up.
Way better covers. And, like, this is, like...
They are pretty rad.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Japanese covers are incredible. But just the scenes that really, really do it for me are, like... That slow shot where he's going up the stairs, where it's all the red hallway, and then the scenes in this just insane electronics like filled room is just like with the shag carpet and the angles and just like
love
that so much.
This is one of the weird ones too, where he wrote this like, and it's it's like, wow, you could have done more of this, Brian.
Exactly.
Might not have paid the bills.
Maybe, I don't know. It's pretty great though. Yeah, definitely. Like you said, it's Rocky before Rocky, Rocky Horror Picture Show. But, and yeah, of course, a nod to Phantom of the Opera. If you're a big fan of the opera fan, you'll dig it. If you like Kiss meets the Phantom of the Park, you'll dig it. I don't know.
Clearly, yes.
If you like Billy Zane as a Phantom, you'll dig it.
Yeah, they wanted to sue the film, or like they made them change the name from just The Phantom to The Phantom of Paradise. So I hadn't seen this film at all. I didn't really know it was a De Palma film. I'd seen the cover, like, what's this weird thing? Yeah. And then I watched it and was like, man, this is pretty cool. And I watched like a Blu-ray that someone made a copy of and put it on the internet for me.
That was really nice of them. That's very kind.
Yeah, that's very kind.
That's probably the Laserdisc quality then.
Yeah. This isn't the Blu-ray rip podcast. It's the Laserdisc rip.
Yeah.
So
this film has like I'm gonna get the Blu-ray because I really enjoyed it, and this film has like a 4-track magnetic soundtrack for when it was in theaters, and the mix in this is pretty damn trippy. It's like you wouldn't mix like this today, and this is one of the cool things. Like I'm going like Andy here, like, but it's nice that they've kept the original sort of 4-track mix on the Blu-ray, and it sounds really trippy. Like lots of weird panning and stuff. What?
A lot of good extras on that Blu-ray too, so definitely worth getting.
Cool, yeah.
I feel like the Laserdisc isn't mixed as well. Like I could tell where it could have been really good, and it was just kind of like that might have been the most disappointing part about it. Like it's the Laserdisc had a decent, and I don't know about the Japanese ones, but the US one was just kind of like, oh, this is really good. I want more sound, and it's just not there. So
one thing that I noticed when I saw the film, there's a scene that takes place in a pressing plant. And I don't think you press records like horizontally, do you? Because
you do in the movies.
Yeah.
But it's probably like an injection molding machine, and that's how Laserdiscs were pressed, like horizontally. Whereas like record creation press like this. Yeah. So it could have been a laser. No, it wasn't. It was probably like a toy factory.
Secret actually. Laser factory in the 70s.
Yeah. The prototype.
I love the record labels, like Death Records, and he's releasing all like this Juicy Fruits, like pop music, and like. I love that they just like kind of reused the same like original starting band, like in three different separate bands.
Yeah.
And just so good.
And Garrett Graham's in it as a character named Beef. How can I love Beef. That?
Right? he's so literally Rocky from Rocky Horror. Like
definitely
stabbed just it.
Ripped right off. Yeah. So
I noticed because I saw like a better, I wouldn't have seen this on Laserdisc, I don't think so, but there's like an optical thing with the Death Records in one press conference at an airport. Yes. And the thing is, they were sued. They were going to be called Swan Song Records, but they got threatened by a lawsuit from, what are they called?
Led Zeppelin.
Led Zeppelin,
Led Zeppelin.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That's on the Laserdisc. It's kind of that little kind of shaky-ish moment. Mm. I was like, damn, are they covering something up? I was like.
That's fine. There was some optical weirdness or just visual gaffes in Sisters too. Like there's like a couple of bits where they come up to this insane asylum. There's like a big blob on the left side of the screen. Like they must have been zoomed out on the camera and like just had rounded edges and part of it was obscured. And there's a boom mic when they go inside a bakery in one scene. I was like, oh damn.
Whatever.
Yeah,
it's close.
It's fine. But yeah, that you can get Phantom of the Paradise. You can get pretty cheap on LD. So, I mean. Not super cheap, but
yeah, it's readily available.
Yeah. So the cool thing was, De Palma starts off as this kind of like Hitchcock, like fanboy, and he gets all his homages out of his system, and he's like, I'm done with that. I did Phantom of the Paradise. I'm going to clearly expand myself as an artist, and he made the biggest Hitchcock ripoff of all time, a film called Obsession. Yeah, I mean, it's got a gorgeous Pioneer Special Edition. Ryan's got a badass looking, looks like a Fulci movie from Japan there.
So I have to ask, how is the transfer on your Pioneer Special Edition?
Yeah, it's a kind of hazy looking movie, even at the best of times. So
this was like a potato that was shifted upward, so there were no subtitles, but it was still a potato. Like it was possibly the worst 90s pressing. But the cool thing is it's PILF 1666.
Whoa.
Dude. Yeah. Satan Pilf.
Wow. That's wild.
Yeah. I never saw this when I was growing up, but I just remember watching it on cable or something at one point. And I was already a huge Vertigo fan. And I'm watching, and it seemed different enough. Like his wife and child are taken. So I'm like, all right. And then John Lithgow is involved and a character kind of similar to a character from Vertigo. And then some characters die, and then there's someone that looks like them. I'm like, motherfucker, you're just doing Vertigo, you motherfucker. And he has Bernard Herrmann to do the Vertigo score again, basically. And yeah, I mean, I understand you need a paycheck when you're an old man. So you'll be like, sure, what the hell? Yeah. But yeah, apparently Paul Schrader did the script. And then De Palma was like, yeah, can you make it more like exactly like Vertigo? And he's like, no. And so he walked away apparently at some point. So here's what we got. So yeah, but I had to have it, you know, because it's on Laserdisc and that's a Pioneer special edition with that gorgeous. Yeah.
But here's the real lesser.
Yeah. Classic Columbia with the laser video disc banner there in the corner. Hell yeah. So, all right. There you go.
I mean, him and his daughter, but not quite, but wanted. I'm gonna put it out there.
Like, yeah, it gets a little weird with the relationships there. Yeah, because you're like, all right, I found this lady that reminds me of somebody. Let's hook up. Oh, we might be related.
Spoiler alert, but also,
creep alert. Yeah. I shouldn't say it's a total ripoff. Instead of San Francisco, it takes place in New Orleans, so it's totally different.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
There you go. Anyways, luckily, also in 1976, a little bit later on in the year, he dropped a beast called Carrie, which, actually I have the AC3 coming to me, but that's a nice 97, 98 release. Yeah.
Nice, decent, smoking, pressing, good sync mix. Like,
on the plus side, it's letterbox. On the negative side, Spencer's going to hate it because it's not the original theatrical audio. So
it looks great, sounds great. You're buying it on Laserdisc, splurge like the extra $3 for this one.
Yeah, it's not that expensive. Yeah, you got the Japanese one too, though, Max, which is also around that same period, I think. Yeah. Hell yeah. Oh, that's why you like it. It's got an image on it.
This is Dolby Digital also.
Yeah, that all came out like, I don't know if it's like right after the US one, but right around the same time, late 90s.
This is 97.
Yeah.
It's the way to do it, though.
But yeah, I mean, the
criterion is ERP and MERT, so you get MERT image.
Yeah, apparently it's ERP and MERT at De Palma's behest. It says right on there.
Yep.
Yeah.
Sure it is.
Something like that, but. It's got some bonus. This is actually one of the, because I've just got the Jabroni CLV one, and it actually has special features. Unlike Criterion's like, you know, it's impossible to put special features on a CLV disc. You're like, is it? Or are you guys just dicks and want us to pay more to get the CAV?
So,
yeah.
I don't have the CLV, so I need that to get all the variants. Got to catch them all.
I think the logo is different on.
Yeah. They are
a bit different. Yeah. So there's a couple different variations. And definitely a solid flick. I mean, adaptation of the Stephen King novel, Sissy Spacek. You got John Travolta showing up. And he says, get her done. The first person I ever heard say, get her done in a movie. So,
wow.
Yeah, man, everyone in that movie was horrible as a person, though.
True, right?
Literally, I mean, every character just about was like, you're a horrible you're outdoing the first two horrible people. Like, it was just like
her mom, hey, Piper Laurie from Twin Peaks is in it. Yeah, she's horrible.
Everyone is horrible in it.
They're all gonna laugh at you.
Yeah.
Good point. Yeah, everybody in there, so many great people in this thing. So yeah, Nancy Allen, of course, in there. She'll be in everything. So yeah, get Carrie on Laserdisc, but splurge for those late 90s ones for sure. So
let them butcher the audio and make it sound good.
You got to have the original audio too, Ryan. So got to have every copy. Yeah. If you're going to be complete. Anyways, so at that point, I guess he was getting typecast into like telekinetic movies, as one does, and dropped another flick that I watched a lot when I was a youth. Ooh. The Furries. Oh, wait, no, The Fury. And like what? There's not many pressings of this sucker, right? There's no...
And maybe the Japanese of this.
Yeah.
Yes, like same cover looking though.
No letterbox that I saw.
Nope, just like...
Yeah.
Yeah, we're good.
We made a VHS of it. You're gonna like it.
Did you watch this recently, Seth, or was that Ryan?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, I really enjoyed this. The scene where she puts on the thing... first of all, Kirk Douglas... bare chest, machine gun, shooting people in the Middle East. Like, or like, terrorists. He wasn't, yeah. He wasn't particularly, but he's shooting terrorists. And I haven't seen Douglas in like that many, you know, common in current times films, like Spartacus, you know, the
sort tough of guys.
90.
Tough guys.
Whew. Yeah.
That's okay. Next on your list.
Tough guys.
Okay. I have to look up that one. But yeah.
Yep.
He really kicks ass there. And then we have a scene at the when they're like doing tryouts to come to the special school, and she puts on the thing to do the alpha, and like the train just rushes off. Yeah. And she sees premonitions. Really cool. And then there was a cool rear projection thing he did with when she also like a premonition of how the kid fell out the window. A lot of cool stuff. And
yeah,
then,
it's very like it predates Stephen King's Firestarter. It's got some similar vibes with that. Yeah. And I don't know.
It's cool. I think it's a really cool movie, but it's so fucking slow.
Yeah, like, Ryan doesn't like the 2 hours-ness of a lot
awesome
of
awesome sequence, and then let's build for 25 minutes to the next awesome sequence.
It was the 70s.
Yeah. Like, it's not made for the modern era at all. Like, there was lots of really cool things. It was a really cool story, but man.
Got John Williams to do the score this time. Yeah,
it was a lot.
Yeah. John Williams tries to do Hitchcock. I don't know, like Bernard Herrmann.
Charles Durning again, showing up. If you're a big Durning fan, yeah. Mm-hmm. I liked watching this a lot when I was younger. So
it was very good. Like I suggest checking it out. Don't get me wrong, but man, you have 2 hours, and he's going to use all of those 2 hours to explain everything.
All right.
And you have like a throbbing vein.
All right, so. Moving into the 80s now, who's got home movies? Yeah, Kirk Douglas back again, baby.
Whoa.
Garrett Graham, Nancy Allen, everybody that he knows. I have not seen this, but a word on the street is he was teaching a class, like a film class, and basically used this as like a hands-on kind of technique. Yeah, just have everybody just make a movie with him. Super low budget.
Oh, they had multiple sequences of blackface, so...
Oh. That was fine in 1980, right?
Sure. I don't know. This was another one that I felt was like not rewarding, and it just wasn't funny. He should not do comedies. He's not funny, and that's okay.
Yeah, that's not funny. Cool, man.
He's got other things. He's really good at it, and that's not comedy.
Yeah.
Yep. Also, Image 4x3.
Pretty jabroni, yeah.
Oh, yeah, totally jabroni.
I mean,
no explosions.
Well, I mean, luckily in 1980, he also learned that, you know, he should go back to the Hitchcock well.
It opens up like it should be on Showtime and closes like it should be on Showtime.
Good point.
Like, two extended shower sequences, like.
Yeah, well,
how long is the shower sequence? He's like, come on.
Well, Max has got that OG.
Especially the second one, like, all right, this is coming. And then let's go back to the shower for a while and go really slow in the shower.
I see the restaurant.
We're paying her to be in the shower. We're going to show it all.
Image restaurant here.
Again. Yeah, I just have Orion. Yeah.
This is a smoke and transfer, though. Like,
yeah, this is nice.
What, like 94 or something?
Yeah, I think I got 93 on here.
Yeah. This is
it's a nice release.
Spoken good transfer to find. Yeah. So if you're a fan of the movie, which it's entertaining.
Like my mom is not.
Crazy.
My mom is not too.
This is one of the ones she went to see in the theaters. And
the one she saw. Yep. Same thing. Did she tell you this? Did she tell you that she hated the freaking curtains?
Oh, hell yeah. This is an anti-mom.
Sorry, mom.
Yeah. Sorry. But, don't show this to your moms, guys.
Yeah, even my grandma said the same thing. She said, my grandma has said there are like two movies that I should never watch. Me, telling me I should never watch them. And it's Psycho and freaking Dressed to Kill.
Yeah.
It's not like showers or something.
And of course, yes, he's ripping off Psycho and other things in this one too. So it's fun. You know, spot the influences. You know,
well, it's funny because like in The Phantom of the Paradise, there's that Psycho scene too, because Beef's in the shower. And the Phantom comes into the shower.
Yeah.
But then he gives a plunger on the face instead. So
unrated.
Actually, that made me laugh.
Yeah, I laughed
at that. So
Oh. That's always the interesting thing about De Palma. Even when he's like ripping off these thrillers and stuff, it's like it's almost a parody. Like some people are like not quite sure if he's fully serious about what he's doing. And yeah, so it's pretty interesting.
Here's 3 minutes of shower to determine.
Yeah. Michael Caine, did he ever return for more De Palma, or was that?
I don't think so.
He might have been like, I'm out.
Yeah.
Angie Dickinson, Nancy Allen, of course. I think they were still married at this point.
Ah, I see. Okay. Yep. So, and so the kid, show up. And then there's the kid from, what's it called? The film about the car that goes mad.
The car?
Christine.
Oh, yeah. Keith Gordon.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was like a big early Arnie feature. I think he was in Home Movies too, right? Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
Yeah. Skip Home Movies.
Okay.
Fine.
Yeah.
Other things. Dennis Franz.
Dennis Franz.
Yeah. He plays a cop.
Yep.
Kind of love him. And then he moved away from John Williams and was using was his boy Pino Donaggio, I think, doing the music on this. He does like a ton of De Palma budget films.
So. John Williams.
Budget John Williams is even better. All right, so Dressed to Kill. Moms don't like it. But.
No, they don't. My mom literally said she saw that in the drive-in movie in 1980 when it came out. And she said that to this day, she still can't help but touch a curtain just to be sure.
Just make sure. Yep.
Just to make sure.
Yeah, we gotta get into some 1981 blowout action.
Yeah.
There's a Vestron too. Who's got? Yes, I sold my Vestron. I shouldn't have, but Max has got it covered.
Yeah.
Image again, bringing the thunder.
Yeah. Vestron Image combos.
93 again. I like this film. This is a lot of fun. It's, it's not just a Hitchcock ripoff. It's also a ripoff of Michelangelo Antonioni and Blow Up. But
it's one of my favorites. I love Blow Up.
Yeah. Again, the jacket is interesting because it's glossy, but it's got that gloss where it fogs over.
Yeah, I know. Mine's fogged.
And normally you can fix that with microfiber cloths, but this is impervious to it. Like, it is like, no, I will be fogged for all eternity. It's nothing you can do.
I just feel like this cover really does not do the movie justice in a way, though. No. Like, this is just not giving me what this is.
No.
Like, at all. Like, at
There's
all.
No blowout on the cover.
Good point. Yeah.
Oh, so, my God.
Are you lighting things on fire over there?
Oh, yeah. No, I'm trying to see if a little lighter.
Bonsonall? Yeah. Let me know. Yeah, you can see it if I can catch it on the light. There we go.
Nope. Forever fog. Yeah. Sorry. Forever fogged. Like, it's not helping. I tried to trick Sam. Add a little extra for podcast.
So does that get fogged with the fingerprints, or is it something else that makes it foggy?
It's something else altogether.
Something else. And then the fingerprints add a little extra like grease to bring it back, if you notice.
Yeah, but you can see it's like it's just mottled and weird. It's not fingerprint related. Yeah.
It's like a mat that fogs and then you never get it back. Something. Yeah. I don't know. It's weird.
But as of the film itself, John Travolta plays a sound engineer. So it's cool. It's like a film about films, but it's not in Hollywood, which is cool. Because normally everyone would be like, no offense to Hollywood, sorry. But it's also cool that it's in, Philadelphia? So that's kind of different. So he plays a guy who's out getting sounds for cheap horror movies. It's great because there's a scene at the studio where there's like posters for Uli Lommel's Boogeyman and all sorts of great horror movies on the walls. And he's trying to get wind sounds. And of course, he hears and sees an accident and rescues Nancy Allen from a car that falls into the lake. And she's great because she's got this like, old timey, like, I don't know, gangster mall kind of voice or something. And come to find out the guy that was driving the car is a big time politician and it may have been assassinated. And this guy might know the answers to what's going on. But
John Lithgow.
Yep.
Return of the Lithgow.
Dennis Franz.
Dennis Franz returning. Yep.
He's the guy that records this. Yeah.
He's got some photographs that he has taken. So.
Yeah, like the Zapruder film.
Exactly, and then John Travolta takes and makes an animation out of them and syncs it.
There's so many cool like sort of movie making things or like behind the scenes stuff, and then there's one thing that's a bit ridiculous how they wipe the tapes, but
that guy's got
Hollywood logic.
Yeah,
But I mean, I get why like Tarantino was a huge fan of this. That makes sense. You know, yeah. I mean, John Travolta, like this kind of like led to Pulp Fiction because
it did. Yeah.
You could just
good serious role.
Yeah, he's just so comfortable in it too. I'm like, damn, why didn't he make more of these? It's damn, no offense to what all those dance talking movies and talking baby movies, but like he was really crushing it.
Yeah.
I know, it looks great. Yeah.
When Tarantino was gonna make Pulp Fiction, he said, like, I want to have Travolta, and people were like, what? Well, look at Blowout.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's how it was. And I also think that there's an interview with him just before Pulp Fiction or like after Reservoir Dogs, where he's at the video store and he's like, picks three films. This is one. The other one is Laserdisc, the Criterion Taxi Driver, and like some Western, Rio Bravo or something.
Oh, yeah. He loves Howard Hawks Western. So that makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. He has the Rio Bravo poster at the freaking Beverly's.
Oh, does he?
Okay. Yeah. That was.
Just like the early scenes were like that, the hospital, and it's like, I don't know, Travolta's walking around like he owns the place. He's just so cool, and like, yep. I don't know.
It's just a really carryover from the 70s where he was so cool.
I was buying it, man.
I was buying his albums.
Yeah, I mean,
he had record deals. He was a heartthrob. He was crushing it.
Yeah.
True story. I went into the Bloomfield, Connecticut, Capaco Shopping Plaza barber with a copy of Grease on LP, told him to give me that, and then also later told him to give me the Saturday Night Fever haircut, and he refused to, and him and my mom laughed at me, and I was outraged as a young child because I'm like, I am the customer.
Oh my god, how
I want to look like Travolta.
Greatest haircut of all time. What the heck?
I'm not even 10 years old, but I want to look like Travolta. You know, I don't know.
Who doesn't?
I love this.
I saw Look Who's Talking in theaters and with my mom. She was
as
like,
did I?
You watch a Travolta movie. You watch a Travolta movie. It's like, what's a Travolta? And like, she was like, yeah. So I get it now. I get it now why she was like that to watch a Travolta movie. But yeah.
All right. We're moving into prime 80s territory now, 1983. And we're stepping away from John Williams and getting the Giorgio Moroder in here with some Scarface. And this is like Miami Vice before Miami Vice. Super violent, super over the top. I mean, this was the movie that everybody rented and then, you know, sent the kids out of the room when the chainsaw scene happened, including myself.
So like my parents, 5 minutes in?
My parents let me watch a lot of stuff, and this was one of the things they're like, yeah, now you gotta leave the room for a while.
they really don't show anything.
It made it worse.
Yeah.
Being in the other room, hearing a chainsaw in the distance made it way worse than I watched it. I was like, oh, okay.
Because you're hearing the scene and you're like, what's going on? And it's like, you could have just watched
guys getting sawed in slow-mo. But yeah, they did a signature. So you got that. You got Letterboxd Universal.
Yeah.
Nice.
The one thing that like, I don't know, it's really entertaining, great film, totally quotable. Nobody learns a damn thing from this. Like, none of the characters grow at all. Yeah.
Nor the fans of this movie. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're like, Tony Montana, he's the best guy. I'm like, yeah, is he?
But no.
He gets high on his own supply. He ruins everything.
Literally in the first 10 minutes, they're like, don't get high on your own supply. And he's like, fuck that. I want mountain all of coke. It. Mountains.
Like, yeah, he's not the guy to emulate. Like maybe the first part of the movie. Chick
that just gets high all the time on the supply. Like,
I love Michelle Pfeiffer in this.
Michelle, man, yeah.
Freaking musical score is like legendary. Yep. This movie is just like just the entire, like, you are immersed in that whole feel of that, and you were living in it. You were living in Miami when you watch this.
Yeah, that's the running time is actually, it's good that this is long because you're really steeping in it.
170 minutes.
It does not feel like if you didn't have side flips, then you would not feel like you were smooth.
It's got a few on this one. It's a big box, but. Yeah. Yeah.
I could have watched two of my regular movies for this, so it was good enough to keep going. Just saying, if you're on the fence.
Yeah. And I mean, if you're a hip hop artist, you have to have a copy of this. Maybe not on Laserdisc, but you have to have a copy of it. So,
yeah. So is it like a cliche in the US too, to have like, if you're like, if you want a wannabe gangster, you have the poster on the wall?
Yes. Yeah. Especially if you have the sunset poster from within the film. That's even that's like next level.
Whoa. Yeah. That's like, whoa.
If you have the sunset wall, you're like Tony Montana Jr.
And this is like Tony Montana's house. Where's the mountain of cocaine, man?
I'm going to do everything he did. And
Tony Montana isn't related to Hannah Montana. There's no relation.
There's no relation.
This is a spiritual prequel. Or
yeah.
Hannah Montana's that was Billy film. Ray Cyrus. It's a sequel. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, everybody's seen Scarface. You know it's good. So I think people like that movie without any knowledge about De Palma being involved in it. But.
Yeah.
For
sure.
Doesn't feel like a De Palma. There's no real twist. It's just.
No, right?
To the wall, bash it.
Yeah.
But like you, I mean, you can see the shots. You see, you feel that shots. That's where he shines.
Yeah. Did he do any split screen? I don't remember any like split screen moments in there.
But. I don't think in that one.
What about the montage? Is there anything in that one with the counting money and stuff, or is like real regular
scenes? Yeah, I'm gonna have to watch that again.
That's the only thing I could think of, because it was a long time since I saw it, but that's the only place I could think of it.
I was going to say there's a great split scene in Phantom of the Paradise where it's like they're pushing this car out and there's like a bomb in the back of the car.
Oh yeah.
And then there's the scene where they're doing the music at the same time, and that was like the first one where I was like, wow, that's kind of like, I like how that feels, like you're getting so many viewpoints, but they're like literally, they may as well be literally standing next to each other and what's happening. Mm. But it's just like you're getting that angle. It was cool.
He's gonna blow shit up, and you're like, "This music's so good, I don't care."
Just keep going. Like literally, they're just like, still going with it, and it is.
Yeah. All right. There's some good music in the next one. We're still in the depths of the '80s. It's good times here, and you know, style wise, he's into action movies. So now it's time to go back to the Hitchcock trough.
Yeah. Wow.
This time we're doing Vertigo. We're doing Rear Window. We're doing a bit of everything.
We're doing Body Laser Dog. Rot.
Yes.
Oh, you guys got Rot? Oh,
it's BADC, I believe.
It is.
Damn. Yeah.
I'm Rot Free. Yeah.
I watched a different copy after the side break. I was just like,
bummer.
It's rough. DADC. Yep. You got a lot of noise.
You just watched this recently, Seth, right?
Yep. Never seen before. And it starts off like sort of like some sort of it's a movie set thing again. You know,
yes,
like
the, movie within a movie again.
Movie in a movie. So, and then it turns into this sort of like, you know, Showtime softcore porn. What
I read that like he wanted to have like actual sex in the movie, and Hollywood was like, his producers were like, no, you can do your movie, but no, we have to actually make money off of it. Like,
After Scarface, everyone just kept complaining about his excess and, you know, his other films with violence and sex. And he's like, well, screw it. I'm just going to make the nastiest, porniest movie I can.
I mean, it's still pretty porny and, you know.
It is.
Yeah.
Cinemax,
Oh, man. And the main character, Craig Wasson's character, he's such a freaking loser. Chud.
Milk toasts.
Yeah. Oh man, but it's great. Yeah, he's an actor with claustrophobia and ends up watching a house for a guy who's watching it for somebody else, and they're out of town, and he goes out of town, and conveniently there's a hot stripper kind of action scene going on across the street that you can tune in at the exact same time every night on the telescope to watch. Yeah.
It's like clockwork.
And the telescope theme by Pino Donaggio freaking rocks. I love that theme. It's just like so cool and chill. And like, yeah, if I was doing some sort of like lounge kind of DJing late at night, I would put that track on. It's pretty badass.
And then there's some sort of goblin man, but turn on that there's something.
That is interesting.
Looks like something from Lord of the Rings or like a bad. But I get it because that's the plot. So
It's great. It's like Vertigo, but like if like Jimmy Stewart was like way crazier and into sniffing panties and like he's just like next level.
Super warrior.
Imagine
yeah.
Too bad we don't have Spencer because he'd probably do like a Jimmy Stewart impersonation, like say something like, "I like to watch."
Yeah. Yeah, like this guy just makes the worst decisions. He's super creepy. I love the lady at the store when he shows up at the mall and she's just like, freaking Creeper Joe out there. Like, yeah. Call the security on him.
We got a creeper again. Lock him up.
Yeah. What was that, Max?
Oh, I had watched this like way back for another topic, and I forget what topic it even was. I don't know. It might have been something. It might have been the Los Angeles topic. I forget the topic, but I watched this long ago.
Architecture, that house he's in is freaking rad.
Legend. The legend. Bed.
Dude, yeah, so awesome.
the whole I just like, so I've seen like some of Rear Window and some of, but I've never seen like all of any of those to know the tropes of all of that really. So like I get like the voyeurism of it, but like watching this I was like very confused because I was just like, this guy is like a psycho. Like, what is going on? Like, and I'm like, what am I?
And the cops kind of know. Right, they're now? Like, dude, you're creepy.
Dude, we don't care what you say. You're like spying on a chick in a telescope.
I was like, I felt like creepy watching him watching her. And I was just like, what am I doing with my life? Like,
I literally had this and upstairs with my blinds open, like you can kind of see in, and I'm on lunch break and I'm like, you know, I actually don't want someone walking by seeing me watch this movie. Let me lower these blinds.
But this is the Frankie Goes to Hollywood.
Dude, like right, that's like right, pretty close to like the second side, right? Like early on is like freaking relax. Like
that's so that thumps. That was great.
Like, there's like a music video in the movie. It's awesome.
Well, was that song done for the film or?
No, but they had done like a couple different videos.
They did a music video because of the film, right?
Yeah. They were just like, we're making a music video porn extravaganza thing. Yeah. It was like perfect synergy. Yeah.
Oh my God. It's crazy.
I was a huge Frankie fan at the time. So that
and
was.
And then we're going to do Zoolander from it.
Yeah.
Right. But I just love, like, all of a sudden he shows up in his, like, cool, like, slick back hair. Like, obviously, they didn't show him getting ready to go, like, audition for a porn role. He's just all of a sudden there.
He was ready.
And he's, like, super cool.
He did audition.
What's that?
He did audition.
Yeah, but they didn't, like, he just, like, changed characters almost, kind of like.
Yeah. He's, like, in the film. There's no, like, prep time there. And
Like, no picture of him in the bathroom going, you know, maybe I could,
Yeah.
But yeah, so straight then back. He meets, of course, Holly Body, played by Melanie Griffith, who stole the show.
Spoken in that one.
I love when she's just walking down the street, like complaining about all the crazy shit going on. I my mom does not approve of this film.
I don't know if anyone approves of that film.
I don't know. I like it.
It's a trip and a fun watch.
Yeah.
By the end of it, I was like, I like this. And side one was a little tough. Like,
you need to take a shower afterwards.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, there's like you're supposed to relate to the main character somewhat. You're like, this guy. No. Nope.
Maybe we were claustrophobic. Maybe.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Maybe. Otherwise, nope.
Oh, man. Oh.
One question. Is sardine like a proper game or was that made up for the film? Like, I'm a sardine. Hiding behind the fridge.
Tight in a can.
Yeah, being in a sardine can. Like, yeah.
Yeah, but there's not like, oh, let's play hide and seek is one thing, tag or whatever, but like, let's play sardine. No.
No, that's
not that I know of.
Not a common American game. No.
That's a Swedish thing.
Like sardines on the weekend.
Yeah, the whole scene where he's at the acting seminar there and the guy's like tormenting him is like so messed up. Anyways, but yeah, so if you love that, you're gonna love it's not an LD first at 1986's film that Seth is a huge fan of. Comedy, of course, we determined that De Palma plus comedy equals quality.
DeFace Palm.
But you get DeVito in there and Joe Piscopo and Harvey Keitel and Wise Guys is like a slam dunk, right?
Yeah, like the one movie that should be on Laserdisc just an 80s comedy.
Yeah, how did that not get on LD?
Oh, we missed that one. Like, what?
Really?
Bombed so bad that they could not bring themselves to press it.
Yeah. I've got Leonard Part 6 on LD, but there's no Wise Guys, right?
Sam's got three copies of Leonard Part 6.
Which studio is this? Was MGM? Yeah.
Oh, good question.
Oh. Yeah,
quick, to the internet.
I checked. It was probably MGM. It was like an MGM logo at the trailer and IMDb. Yeah, I saw this recently. It's I get so offended by a comedy that's not funny, and it feels like it also, as Ryan mentioned, like dated. The humor is very dated in this one. It feels like Martin Lewis. I haven't seen Martin Lewis, but like Jerry Lewis, like Joe Piscopo is like channeling Jerry Lewis, like. What?
Oh yeah, he's really
yeah that sort of stuff. And then there's like
hamming it,
racked up cameras that people run really fast. Oh, wow,
Keystone Cops. Yeah.
What else?
Luckily, he made up for it with some better cops in 1987. Hooked up with David Mamet. Got some Connery in there, some De Niro again.
Ah.
It's Untouchables time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you got to get the AC3 Stealth 3 issue.
Okay.
Yeah.
Go get it.
Yeah. And this time he's ripping off Eisenstein with Battleship Potemkin stairway scene, which was itself ripped off in other movies from this, like Naked Gun 33 and a third.
Yeah.
Elliot Ness and his crew versus Capone. Billy Drago.
I watched this a lot in my youth, and when I saw the Potemkin thing, I was so let down. I was like, what? I didn't know who De Palma was or anything. Like, man, he ripped something off. I love that scene. And now when I have, like, you know, the facts, he rips off all the time. So now I can forgive him more.
That's his thing. Yeah. So he's cool with it. Yeah. Ennio Morricone doing the score on this one. So another maestro.
Cool.
Yeah. It's good stuff. Okay, yeah, there's some... Back. Some Japanese pressings, right? But nothing touches this thing, probably.
That's best pressing.
Yeah, best pressing.
Baby carriage sequence. Yep. It's just phenomenal.
Yeah, it crushes. And Costner's in it, and I don't mind him. I'm normally not I'm an anti-Costnerite, but he's fine in this, so. Yeah.
I heard De Niro went full, like, immersive becoming Al Capone, or that he freaking, like, he like started wearing his same type of underwear, some crazy business. Like,
yeah.
Surprised he didn't get syphilis to get the full Capone experience. Yeah.
It's crazy. He's pretty good. He's pretty good as Capone.
Yeah, not bad. You got Andy Garcia in there too. And Sean Connery. Chris Howler's in it? What?
Totally.
Cool. Anyways. So, yeah. I mean, again, if you don't like Brian De Palma films, there's a chance you might like this one.
Yeah.
This one and Scarface are from the back catalog of films you'll probably like there.
Yeah. Cool. Moving on to 1989, when Vietnam movies were hot. Dropped this little doozy. Casualties of War, a film that I avoided on Laserdisc for the longest time because I didn't realize it had theatrical presentation format. It's actually widescreen, even though it looks like a late 80s, early 90s Columbia release. It's stealth letterboxing. This movie's a bummer, though.
Explain it.
Yeah.
How many sales did they lose based on that wording?
Special theatrical presentation. Yeah. So many of these probably went back to the shop like, it's messed up. There's some black bars on it.
Yeah. 1990.
Yeah. Yeah. This was like, early letterboxing for non-criterion. Oh, in the back, all right. At the request of the filmmakers, Casualties of War is presented in the letterbox format. So there you go. Yep. 120 minutes.
Every time.
Yeah. I like that Sean Penn looks like Bruce Campbell when his face is long in Army of Darkness when it gets sucked into the book. But this movie's a total bummer. Yeah.
Yeah, it's not that very uplifting, though.
Yeah.
And I also have a problem, you know, Michael J. Fox's character is, you know, seeing really war atrocities and, like, war crimes. And still, I'm seeing the guy that, I'm going to touch my mommy in a bad way. So I have a hard time believing that he is this soldier, and I didn't see Marty McFly, unfortunately. And
yeah, I mean, Sean I don't Penn, think gritty kind of with Fox. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Gritty war
Penn film. Sounds like a cartoon character. Like, I don't know. Let's kidnap a woman or something.
Yeah.
Sounds really funny. But yeah. There's an actor that made his first appearance in this film. Does anyone know who that is?
Let's see.
His name is John C. Reilly.
What? John C. Reilly?
Credited.
Yeah. Yeah, he's credited, yeah. But yeah. He replaced some Baldwin brother or something.
Oh,
so he's going to be an extra. And then,
probably yeah, Billy.
And then
he, yeah, probably Billy.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Surprised James Remar wasn't in it. And get.
I know. What? How is he not even...
And then there's John Leguizamo is in it. And
oh, yeah.
Who else?
Ennio Morricone doing Rames. The music again?
Nice.
Yeah. The guy Sean from... Penn movie with De Palma, right?
Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to think if they did anything before. No, I don't think so.
In Rames, yeah.
Yeah. Was Dennis Franz in it?
This is the first and last Penn Fox movie.
Right,
they did not like each other.
They didn't. Yeah, he didn't drag him into the Back to the Future series. Yeah,
no, they did not like each other. That's the word on the street, and the De Palma used that to their character's advantage. You know,
I mean, yeah, that's perfect, right?
They hated each other.
That makes for sizzle right on the screen. Yeah, not too many pressings of this, right? Like,
I don't know. Is the only one I've seen.
And
this is the one and only copy I've ever had.
Yeah.
Pretty hard to come by, I guess.
It's the theatrical cut, I guess. There's an extended cut where they're added two scenes, an interrogation scene and a cross-examination scene of Michael J. Fox's character, which you could live without those. But I think it's kind of nice, the cross-examination scene in the end, because the trial is very scaled down. It's not like the other trial movie I saw recently, but
you can't handle the truth.
That one, yeah, that one, that one. That one.
Few Good Men,
yeah, Few Good Men, yeah. But yeah, I think it's decent. So, but yeah.
There you go, Casualties of War. So there you go.
It bombed, right? It didn't do well in the box.
No, because that was it. They're like Vietnam movies, like are always smoking hot hits. So this is gonna be a smoking hot hit, and it came in like out fourth place or something. Yeah. Oh, wow. Anyways, luckily his next movie was a global smash, the biggest movie of the century, 1990s, The Bonfire of the Vanities, which...
Bonfire at the Box Office.
I still haven't watched this. This was on my list of homework to do for this podcast, and I still haven't watched this.
Man, this is an unforgettable, forgettable movie, because it's just... Yeah. It's like, oh, you've got this great cast.
No, this
you've got this great cast. Tom Hanks was in this? Oh.
Yeah.
He was not good.
Miscast.
Bruce Willis. He's a great action star.
Yeah.
He's a writer.
Yeah. Yeah, and he was just kind of dropped in because they couldn't get somebody else to do it, right?
This is moonlighting Bruce Willis. This is what
definitely. Look at that picture. He's like,
hey. It totally is, but like... This like it's got a great opening sequence.
Moonlighting.
Yeah.
And you've got like a hammered Bruce Willis getting dressed, and like he's supposed to be going to this like press conference, and he's just like drunk, and they're like carrying him along and slowly getting but like the rest of the movie is just such a letdown. Like Tom Hanks is boring. It's like, oh, you got Tom Hanks. Everybody loves Tom Hanks. Well, they made Tom Hanks not likable.
Yeah, don't they kill a kid like early on? And then this
kind of not really.
A young guy. I don't
know. Yeah.
And the whole thing is just really like, I don't know, it's like hack 80s writing that somehow got a green light and A-listers attached to it.
It's a book to start with.
Yeah, what, Tom Wolfe?
Yeah. Tom Wolfe, yeah.
Never
might have been
it.
A much better book.
That's what everyone has said.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, this was like a hot property. So everyone's like, well, this is going to be a great movie, obviously. And you got...
He just murdered the book. He just ripped it to shreds.
Yeah. So sorry, everybody.
It's because of this film that I thought about this topic. So I listened to a podcast about this film. So
this woman
she made a book about the film, and then they made like podcast of her like micro cassette tapes with interviews from the era. And in that, on the podcast, they talked to Steven Spielberg, and he says like, "Yeah, anyone could have done this film. Like, you know, you could have bought Polanski, we could have got like Frankenheimer or whatever, but." No other director could have done Sisters or whatever. That those are De Palma films. This is not a De Palma film. It's like a, you know, a gun for hire in this one.
Yeah.
But in true De Palma fashion, it was over 2 hours.
Yeah, this is two discs, baby.
Yeah. Damn.
This is loaded. Yeah. And the last side is CAV, so you can still frame all that action.
It really helped. Like the sequence where he was walking across the glass with bare feet. Wait, no, that's not this one.
No, not this one. Yeah, yeah. Never mind.
No.
I don't know. There you go. But
there's some cool stories when they made the film, though. How they when they shot the opening sequence, when the assistant director walked into like a glass, no, like an ice sculpture and cut his head. Ooh. But they need to shoot it, so they had like a nurse that would keep opening his scar, and not because he needed
stitches. For continuity.
Yeah, no. So because they needed, it shouldn't heal because that would be a bigger scar. So she was keeping
to open. Get ready for stitches.
Yeah. And Brian De Palma himself sits on like a golf cart, because the camera travels quite a far distance on one of those golf carts.
How's it look? At least does it have cool split diopter shots or any cool De Palma?
Yeah, it's got all of those things.
Okay, and
it doesn't help.
Just Morgan Freeman, just so we're.
Wow.
Yeah, he was the judge.
Okay.
He has a speech.
Yeah. He does have a speech. And oh, yeah, Morgan Freeman. Yeah. You've even got Morgan Freeman.
I know.
It doesn't help. It's just so pedestrian.
I like the quote on the back. Yeah. It says, it says vastly entertaining, a great, glorious carnival, but it's just from Richard Freeman from New House
Newspapers.
Because that's the nicest quote that they could possibly get.
Yep. Good old New House Newspapers.
Funny. Yeah.
So funny to me.
Yeah. So there we go. I got it. You can get sealed copies for $3. Yes. Have at it.
This one is sealed.
Yeah, mine was sealed until I put it in the plastic.
One copy I watched was in less nice shape. Someone got very mad at the fact that they probably paid $30 for this, and they tore apart the cover. So,
oh, snap.
Still didn't help the movie.
Yeah, sorry. My homework failed. I didn't watch this sucker, but...
You saved 126 minutes.
Yeah. Well, luckily he learned from his mistakes and was like, you know what? I'm going back to Hitchcock. I saw this film in the theater and I wanted to karate chop the screen in half because this movie is a piece of shit and it's called Raising Kane. It came out in 1992. It really does feel like most of the movie is missing because...
Mm.
Well, it's only 91 minutes, and every other movie he does like this is 120 or close to it or more.
Yeah.
And what a just piece of shit.
Yeah, I mean, when the trailers came out, it looked like a falling down-ish kind of thing. It was like basically like this guy is the straight-laced psychologist. He's married. In the movie, they don't bother to establish his wife like until later when it turns into suddenly her movie. But anyways, and like he learns of an affair and then he splits and no, the affair has nothing to do with it.
He's
like
just
this guy's
split right off the bat. Like,
exactly.
First sequence. Like it feels like the studio was like, no, you're hitting the 90-minute runtime, not the 126 minutes of Bonfire. We saw Bonfire. That didn't help.
Bonfire.
Like people talk about The Shining, like having Jack Nicholson crazy for like this guy is like full on 90 miles an hour crazy immediately. Like what, they like kidnap a girl and like kill her like almost like right as the film starts essentially.
Yep.
Yeah. And then it turns into like his wife's movie, like, and like you're kind of rooting for her to like hook up with her ex-boyfriend because John Lithgow is just so creepy. But yeah, so he plays different versions of himself. There's like the cool version with the sunglasses, and of course that guy's crazy.
It's the only good version of John Lithgow.
I know, right? He's hamming it up. He's having a great time.
Yeah.
And then there's the possible like old father character. Yeah, who's? Oh yeah.
Yeah, he plays his father, who's just an older looking version of him.
Yeah, and then you got Stephen Bauer, who's like the ex of his wife there. So. Yeah, I don't know.
He does a Norwegian accent.
Oh, yeah. I forgot the dad's got the Norwegian accent.
But then he goes like East European, German. Like, it feels like he did one scene and they had the dialogue coach on set. And then he's like, bleh.
I feel like he watched like a Wings Hauser film and was like, I can do that.
Yeah.
And you never get a feeling for like the relationship between him and Lolita Davidovich's character. It's really her and Stephen Bauer's romance. Yeah. Like, I don't like you never I don't know. And then characters are dead so but then they're alive and then they don't bother sequences? To show how what's that
dream sequences that's like
yeah
oh what was it a dream did I put the wrong package in the right drawer and
no, that was the it? Worst oh. You're like oh whew. Open a drawer oh the package is there or it's not there so drawn out
I found this at a store for $6 and it was too much so
yeah
I think you get in like a lot keep it watch yeah. it
I think don't it was, go buy it I think it was free and it was too much
yeah and for a, like a 90s Universal pressing it's kind of potato-y too it's not that great
it's not great it's not terrible but it's not great no. It's just average
not great
it's a quote from People magazine because yep. People magazine really knows about De Palma
here. And that's who I look for in a movie is People
good point
De Palma at last has his psycho. This is an intelligent shocker that earns its scares. People magazine.
Yeah.
They like found the person who wrote like a high school paper on De Palma. Who were like, here's your big break. Write this.
Who's the guy? He's got Pino Donaggio doing the music again. I don't know, man. So Raising Kane was tough. And it's got like, he has those long tracking shots. This one's got this huge like info dump scene with like Francis Sternhagen, I think, playing it. Like the dad's ex assistant who gives like all the movie's info that they should have established earlier on. Like just one vomiting scene where the cops are following her all through the precinct.
But it was after like the retired cop that they brought in. He was like, oh yeah, I remember this. And he starts like giving all the pizza. This is the person you talk to, and then like wait, what? Like, oh, he's just kicking around the police station because he's retired but doesn't have anything better to do. But he's got all the
he's still working the case.
I can't give it up, man. I'm on the beat.
So, oh my god, yeah. I sadly paid 99 cents to see this at the cheap second run theater. That was too much. But
hopefully, like the popcorn was good.
Yeah,
I guess I don't really remember it, but. But I mean, this is, you got to have it on Laserdisc. Yeah. I mean, I'm just saying.
If you get it, great. You can watch it. But don't pay shipping for this.
All right. We're getting better. And, go for it.
There's some jump scares in this one, and they got me. I'm rarely scared of jump
people
scares.
People was right.
There are some jump scares. Yeah.
And they got me. And like, what?
And there's, so, you know. People was right. The reveal also, with John Lithgow and drag like behind the woman there the one scene that's
and there's also there's a, some feeling of the film it also feels like a bit of like softcore porn acting sort of stuff or like really bad so the whole relationship between the woman with the clock that feels like some sort of softcore porn setup and then you know hook up in a hotel room like it is a letter that you know David Duchovny reads first like
Red Shoe Diaries
one of those or
Raising Kane
or like a bad Stephen King adaptation like made for TV Stephen King also has that sort of feeling to it and really weird
like half the movie's running time is like a Showtime kind of late at night TV show movie thing gotta love it anyways luckily he moved back into gangster Scarface territory a year later with Carlito's Way, which as a DTS, I think, is this the first DTS De Palma we've had so far? Yeah, right.
Someone smokes.
And then some other cat named, John Leguizamo in this, right? No. Sean Penn? I've heard of this Sean Penn guy.
Did you mean Luis Guzman?
That's what I meant. That's podcast favorite, Luis Guzman.
Good if Guzman's in it. Like, automatic.
Yeah, baby. Yeah. Penelope Ann Miller. A little longer, right? Yeah, two discs again. But.
Yeah, I watched this in my W1.
Nice.
On the runtime.
Yeah.
Yep. I had not seen this. I had not seen this before watching it on laser. So
this is another one that's like a big hit amongst people that don't care about Brian De Palma. Like, Pacino fans like it. Gangster movie fans like it. So,
this was one when I said, you know, Carlito's Way. Everyone was like, "Oh, Carlito's Way."
Yeah.
Okay. I'll put that one on first.
This is smoking transfer.
Okay. Yeah.
What year? QED Laser had it half off. So
nice.
Whoever bought it on clearance at QED Laser, they hadn't opened it, but I did.
What year did that drop? 98 maybe
97 98 yeah like it was later And
yeah, because this was 94. Yeah, so this is not even good, Dolby that's Digital. A good
pick, like looking disc. Yeah, it's not bad. I had that.
Yeah.
And I watched it that way. And then I watched this. I'm like, man, like, go find it.
Yeah. Yeah, and then pay a lot.
I don't know.
Yeah. Nowadays, so DTS is hot. You know?
Yep.
Yeah. Did you watch this, Seth?
No, I didn't. I have the DTS, but I didn't have time to watch it. And because I didn't have a player with optical out, I'm going to switch my 5.0 Fun to a R7G in the bedroom where I'm watching most things now because the home theater is
highly recommended. Just throw it on.
You should just send it to me.
Late.
I can send it to you if I have a regular one. I don't care. I don't care about DTS. That's overrated. I don't know.
Okay, yeah. Send it to me then. I'll dispose of it for you.
Not only is it an amazing sound mix, but you add a new transfer on top of it. Like, come on.
So one thing I thought about, like, he's made Bonfire, Raising Kane, and Casualties of Wars 3 in a row. So this one must be pretty redeeming for him to make the next film he's doing. Or
to have a career after.
Yeah, like, because
he doesn't make
this. I'm amazed he gets to do this.
Yeah.
So there's a podcast called How Did This Get Made? And it's like, how did this get made? How did he get Pacino back?
Right? Yeah.
It definitely feels like it's in that same, like, world as Scarface. Like, you're definitely in that environment. Like, maybe he just, like, grew up a little bit and, like, went to jail and then came back. But it's just also ridiculous. Like, 5 years is not that long. They're, like, treating 5 years like it's 25 years. That is one thing I will definitely say.
Listen, if you spend 5 years behind bars, that's, like, 25 years.
But I mean, like, all the people who were, like, in his, like, vicinity of people, like his whole crew, like everyone forgot him after 5 years. Like, I just struggled to believe, like, they're like, oh, Carlito, like they don't, like, they never heard of him and he was, like, in charge. Like, I struggled with that, but, like, beyond that, the weird, like, moments where he's being called Charlie for no reason.
Yeah, that's, like, his nickname, right? Yeah,
but, like, they didn't really give me any reason why he was being called Charlie and then also Carlito. So
I think Sean Penn was great as the weasel lawyer wannabe gangster. Like, amazing. Like, you're like, holy crap, that's Sean Penn.
Yeah, like,
stole that whole movie. Oh my
god, can't really see him that well, but yeah.
And Luis Guzman. Yeah, I mean,
yes,
plus you have you know, Luigi Mario.
Yeah, Benny Blanco from the Bronx.
Yeah, just very good supporting cast. And yep.
Heck yeah.
I mean, Sean Penn's name is huge because he literally stole this movie. Like, he stole it. Incredible. The boat, everything. There's a lot of sweeping shots. Like, I feel like there's a lot of just very De Palma things going on in here.
Yeah, he's showing off in there for sure.
Yeah.
I love the opening sequence where he's with, like, his nephew or whatever, and they go into the barber shop and get buzzed in. And then it just all hell breaks loose. And then he's breaking away as, like, the police are showing up. Like, just great, great sequence. Like, he's in the bathroom yelling and, like, they're all just, like, dead already. He's just yelling and yelling and yelling. Like, then he, like, turns out the lights and, like, oh, it's good.
Yeah. And yeah, it was successful. And then 3 years later, the impossible happens. The dude shows up making one of the biggest films of the year that launched a franchise. The Cruise himself with the De Palma. You got to have the jabroni pan and scan and the widescreen.
There you go.
And
this is a reference disc for 96.
Yeah.
Yeah, reference.
Beautiful Paramount. Yep.
Beautiful. Reference. Just smokes.
Gatefold, baby.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cruise gatefold, mind you.
Yeah.
Not just any gatefold. You could have any gatefold.
I mean, you could theoretically put, like, Ving Rhames in there, Jean Reno, but I mean.
No, you couldn't.
Yeah.
You can't fit them like you can 5'2" Tom Cruise.
Yeah. I guess if there's any disappointment in this film, it's a adaptation of the Mission Impossible TV show about teams. And this is less about the team and more about the Tom.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean.
The team's cool, though.
The team is badass. Like, you have Ving Rhames on your team. You've won. Like,
yeah, Jean Reno, Emmanuel Bear.
Yeah.
There's a little bit of early stuff with an expanded team when, of course, you got Repo Man himself in there, Emilio Estevez.
Yeah.
So
I know it was very, like, you know, like, people were up in arms about it when it came out because of John Boyd's character, like, Yes. The betrayal, like, that didn't happen in the TV show.
That was me.
Yeah.
But like, great cinema.
Yeah.
Great laser.
Yeah, I rewatched.
Great sound.
I remember leaving work early to go see this with my friend for a Tuesday matinee or whatever, and then just being sucked into it. And of course, one that said, like, you know, Job 3, what is it, Job 13 or whatever? I'm like, it's Job, you idiot. It's a biblical reference. Like, then like the Bible's like right there in the shot. Like, yeah, it's good. Lots of show off stuff in here too, and split diapter stuff and
Dutch angles.
Yeah, lots of that. Yeah. Him and Kittredge and Yeah, this smokes on LD. Is it a Japanese one, but the cover is kind of jabroni compared to this, actually.
And it spawned an entire franchise that's still going and still relevant. Like, two great discs, but
three,
they started like, yeah, we've got something here, and just
I dig three.
Smoked on forward. But
yeah,
I mean, two is a late release, so that makes it better anyways. But
sure, yeah.
That's my favorite genre.
Late release genre? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you're a big fan of that, yeah. Sadly, no DTS reissue this because Paramount, they weren't into it. But Wham, wham. But.
So, was it true that the guy that played Phelps on the TV show was offered the part that John Voight got and said no? I have something in the back of my head that says that.
Don't know. We'll put up a yay or an A on the credits there.
I was really disappointed by that. And then I didn't see the sequel. So I haven't seen any sequels. And then I rewatched it recently. No.
Oh, wow. They're really good, except for two.
Two's got some really good John Woo sequences that totally don't have
doves. Doesn't have doves.
Doves.
Churches. Does it have slow motion?
It's got doves. It's got slow motion. It's got
slow motion and the doves are just so like over the top Woo. And you're like, oh, wait, it's Woo, but Tom Cruise.
My favorite part is like they're doing the flamenco dancing and then later they're spinning around in cars. And just to remind you that it's just like the flamenco dancing, they cut back to a flashback of the flamenco dancing. So you're like, I get it.
Yeah.
They're dancing, but like in cars.
Wow. I mean, it was too over the top forced Woo when it didn't need to be. It was,
Limp Bizkit on the soundtrack. I mean,
the only De Palma Mission Impossible. He was
working
time.
Yeah.
So,
but he launched a franchise.
Yep, he did.
But they've had directors that come back on that franchise now, or is it new every time? Or is it like...
Wait, JJ, Brad Bird.
And
then what's his face? Rogue Nation guy? Did he come back for Fallout?
One of them did two in a row, I thought.
Yeah, that was a Rogue Nation guy, which of course I'm totally forgetting his name, but yeah. I think the last two were the same director.
It would be fun if the franchise, because it starts off like one De Palma, which has his style, and then it goes to Woo, which has his style, and and then I don't know who the third one was. Was that
the J.J. Abrams did the third one?
He's got his sort of style, which is also that's kind of fun.
Lens flare.
Yeah, they should have done that with Star Wars. Like, I had two different.
Brian De Palma should have directed the Star Wars.
Trivia, Brian De Palma, what connection does he have with Star Wars?
Well,
he was trying to
bring George Lucas.
Wait, no.
He did something very particular.
Did he, like, I don't know, what is it?
He wrote the opening crawl for the first film.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And also during the screening of the rough cut, he said, this is garbage or something.
As did all of Lucas's spells, probably. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, we're coming to the end of the laser era here. We're gonna go out with a bang though.
Yeah.
And do some snackies. Oh wait, I read that wrong. Snake eyes.
Snake eyes.
Oh, you got the hype sticker. Look at you.
Yeah, this one's sealed. I pulled out the sealed cup.
I got Japanese, but no B.
I watched the Japanese just then a couple hours ago.
Yeah, so it's fresh. What do you think, Seth?
I had seen this when it came out. I didn't know it was De Palma or anything. And this one, everything clicks. It's like, it's not too long. Ryan likes that.
And good point.
All the split screen, the Hitchcocky stuff, comes together. This is like, if we've gone through his filmography now, this is where it pays off. It's perfect.
Yeah, I mean, for his Hitchcock thrillers, this is, This and Sisters are some of my favorites. So
I love this movie.
A cage just eating it up.
Yep. And you've got Lieutenant Dan too.
Lieutenant Dan. Yeah. I mean, no real surprises in any of the twists. Like, I saw the trailer, I'm like, that guy's a bad guy. Yep. Yep. And then I saw the movie, I'm like, all right, that's how it panned out. But it's about the ride.
Yeah, it was a good ride. There were lots of, you know, good characters.
Always. Right? Is Luis Guzman in this film? I heard.
Yes, he is.
Yeah. I heard that Luis Guzman might be in it. Yeah. Yeah. He's in there. Man. Carlo Gugino's in there too. Stan Shaw. Gary Sinise. Ryuichi Sakamoto doing the score. Love it. So,
yeah. Every movie with Guzman, always a winner.
Always smokes. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, I mean, if you're going to go out on LD, you might as well go out with Snake Eyes. So
nice, hot mix, just really solid, like good sound.
Yeah.
You got the whole like storm going on outside. Yep.
Love films where like, there's some sort of storm going on as a metaphor even, or like it ends up being a big part of the final act. And sure enough, in this thing, it does.
Yeah. I always like when the elements play into the final act, like just good.
Yeah.
You're going to tell me there's elements they better play in, or I don't give a shit. I don't care if it's snowing or raining. Or
fire. I don't care. Yeah.
They're indoors until they're not.
Bring it.
Yep.
Sadly, nothing. Mission to Mars would have made a sick Japanese late release.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That could have been a Titan AE or Iron Giant or, one of those like really high price.
Could have been.
Could have been.
What year did that come out? Was it 99 or?
2000.
2000.
De Palma went Disney. Yeah. He's only made six movies after LD. So,
yeah. Could have had some Rebecca Romijn in 2002.
Yeah. Femme Fatale would have made a nice gatefold.
$5,000 Laserdisc right there.
Woo. Yep. I wouldn't have bought Black Dahlia though on LD. I don't know. That movie was ass. And I haven't seen any of the three after that. So.
He's got something in pre-production, IMDb says, called Sweet Vengeance, and Catch and Kill is announced.
Yeah. So, or he's still at it.
Yeah, he's getting old, right?
He's 82? Come on.
Whoa.
He's had a good career. Like, he's got some movies that we'll reference forever, so he's done it.
Yeah. I hope he gets residuals for Scarface posters.
Yeah, he should get residuals, man.
He really should. There's so many of those.
I mean, if you're going to like some sort of outdoor market and they've got cheap, knockoff posters.
You're in Venice. You will find Scarface shirt, Scarface poster, Fight Club reference.
Still frames of Tony Montana blown up poster size.
100%. Him with the sling on.
Listen, how many movies does the Lonely Island reference? Let's be honest. Let's look at the cultural icons of today.
Good point. Yeah.
And Michael Bolton.
De Palma. I hope you like the De Palma Festival there, everybody. Out there. All right. So we're going to do the Wolf Pick. What's, if you had to choose one De Palma movie out of all these LDs, which one are you keeping? What's the De Palma-iest of them all?
Oh, man. I feel like it's got to be Snake Eyes.
That's a good one.
Because it really is like culmination of all of the things.
Snake Eyes is a good choice. Yeah. That's tough. I mean, obviously, I'm not going to get rid of my Mission Impossible, but that doesn't necessarily represent the De Palma.
I feel like, I don't know. Nope. It's a tough call because obviously this is just legendary.
Yeah.
So that's a very tough call. But what is more De Palma? Like, I mean, yes, this has split screens, but like this is just this is literally culmination of all of the things that are.
Yeah, it's like, got the goods.
And it's tight. Like it's 99 minutes or something.
Yeah.
And I feel like both still hold up, but Snake Eyes is. Yeah. It's still that, I mean, Phantom of the Paradise doesn't have that Hitchcock thing to it, which is kind of like absolutely De Palma.
I love the fact that Snake Eyes ends and then like there's the after sequence and they're like in Nick Cage's like, having his downfall and everything. Really, like we got that part. We're like, he wasn't a great guy, but like he was just great in that one instance.
Yeah, I love that ending. It's kind of like the sisters ending where just this long shot of like, construction workers or whatever.
So I because I wasn't pressed for time to be on the podcast, so I Googled the length of the film, and I got like 2 hours or something, 2 hours. And that was like two and a, like some other movie with like G.I. Joe or something that showed up in my Google results.
Oh,
so
wow.
I was expecting it to be a lot longer. And I saw that the first side was like 2 hours something. Oh, man, they packed it fully. So they're going to get both sides to 1 hour on each. It's like, oh, man, this is going to be long. And then whole thing happens. Like, it's going to be half an hour more? What are they going to do?
What can happen?
What can happen now? He's had his downfall. Okay, I get it. But no, that was like another movie. So,
and there's sorry, go ahead. Yeah,
I would keep my Blowout. Japanese.
Blowout's pretty damn good. Yeah.
It was good.
Yeah, I know. I do like Sisters too, but yeah, Blowout or Snake Eyes would be good. There's also a ton of Sony Laserdisc players in some of the control room scenes in Snake Eyes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, behind them, there's like a bunch of wall of gear and like PVM monitors and stuff. And there's
I thought I saw some sort of Kramer-ish switch thing there. They have the right one with the comb filter because that's
the 773 amp.
With the HDMI out. Yep, totally.
Yep. Because, you know, the Eye in the Sky has that. So it's got composite, but they need to.
New Pioneer's logo. So it's probably.
Dude, whoa. Good point. That's fresh. All right. We're shutting down. Hey, we did this fast. This is like the fastest director kind of retrospective we've done.
Oh, one thing. I'm going to keep on watching De Palma films because I have some more to watch. But this is the first time in a long time I've done like a director sort of thing. So watch that Bonfire, Sam. Promise me.
Yeah, I mean, I need to watch that. And I think maybe there's one or two others I still need to check out. So maybe I'll
greetings.
Do it. I have the Arrow box set, the old De Niro films. So.
Yep, you can skip that one.
We should bug Vinny. Maybe I can add Vinny's favorite De Palma in here. I don't know. Slacker. All right. You want to do some pickups?
Yeah.
Let's do this. Man. All right. First thing, I got some gear.
Ooh, gear.
A couple of years ago, or maybe just a year ago, I bought one of those little Extron composite video switcher boxes.
Yeah.
I think it's just four. Yeah. And I'm like, you know, I want to hook up like six players. So let me step it up and get a six switcher with the rack mounts on the side.
Whoa, nice.
So technically I have two of these. This is just the audio one because Extron like to do that thing where there's a special audio output there. And so the one with the video outs, all of the audio I have on mine are all those little blue ones. And the adapters are like $25 a pop. So I'm like, you know what? How about I just get an RCA model and I'll get the video one separately. So I actually have two of these identical kind of boxes like stacked on top of each other, one for audio, one for video. So it's cool. It's got the auto mode on there and so I grabbed that.
Wait. How are you incorporating this? You're plugging all your players into that and then there's one singular audio out?
No, it's actually got two. So I you can get an adapter for this and then there's this one.
Okay, and so that goes to your receiver?
Yeah, so I've got one going to a DVD recorder.
Okay.
And then I've got one going to my like DVDO hub kind of thing. And then that turns into HDMI and pumps it back to my receiver. Yeah.
Amazing. I love it.
So yeah, because I've got six different players analog inputs I can pump into this. So
That's awesome.
Perfect. And then the other one has a bunch. What's that?
Perfect for VHS.
Yeah, I do have a VCR I can hook up to this too. I, of course, I have all the optical and all that stuff going elsewhere. But so the other one's got a bunch of BNC composite switch. In fact, you can feel the holes under here.
Uh-huh.
I was almost hoping the boards were separate so I could just unscrew like the video board and plop it in here and just punch through the holes. In fact, I might Frankenstein these things together someday because
nice.
Yeah, I might be able to do that. That's a good idea. It's a cool little box.
I like it.
So, yeah. And I like the little, chiclet buttons there.
Yeah. Big fan of
the other one I got.
Stuff.
Hold on. Our friend Luke picked this up for me when he was shopping in the middle of nowhere in Japan.
Ooh, nice.
He got me a little Panasonic Muse decoder, but this is Muse to NTSC, which, I mean, normally isn't handy for anybody. But if you wanted to, I don't know, make a DVD copy or make a VHS copy of a Muse thing, or just watch it on a old CRT. It it's got just a couple inputs and outputs, and it takes in the muse from the player and pumps it out as like S video and audio or composite and audio.
That's wild.
So yeah, and it's pretty rad.
Downscaling.
Yeah, it's downscaling. Yeah. So and it's got all the different audio things you can change, like how the audio works, and so yeah, it's just a cute little Panasonic muse box. Yeah, and it shitifies it. So normally I would be like, hell no, but I was like, you know, I don't know. I might make a VHS tape of Sony Fish Face.
That'd be amazing. We need
also, that. I think it's good for testing. You know, if you have like a couple of news discs and the player and you haven't found your decoder yet, these aren't that expensive.
This is good if you're in the field or you're like messing around and you just want to see if the player's working or something like that. You can hook this up to an old TV and be like, bam, all right, yeah. So I couldn't say no. It was super cheap and yeah, it's just kind of a cute little oddity. So yeah.
I like it.
Yeah,
I think Bill does this with a PVM when he calibrates or like to test stuff, I think.
Yeah, he does have a PVM, yeah.
Yeah, and one of those NTSC things.
Yeah. And then Luke, of course, sent a couple LDs. So let's show those quick. He sent me the Japanese El Mariachi, which is cool.
Whoa,
nice. Even though it just pulls a image, kind of, it fakes it because it's just got like a narrow image and then it just stretches it. So the dog's on their toys, the eye's on their toys. Yeah. It does the same on the back too, which is funny because there's like, there's this guitar case again. Yeah.
That's so bizarre. Oh my God.
But it's rot free.
It is. And it has Bedhead on here. Oh. The only drawback a lot of times is Japanese discs is they don't give a crap about American commentary tracks. So yeah, usually lose the commentary tracks, but yeah, the artwork's rad. So,
okay. So the US pressing is rot prone.
Yeah. It's Columbia.
DODC.
And I didn't know this existed until we were just yapping about it in the chat. Widescreen copy of Little Odessa, which, I don't have to deal with my Jabroni Pan and Scan copy.
The US one is Jabroni Pan and Scan?
It is, yeah. And I thought it was like open map, but it's not. This is like a scope movie. No, so,
I guess that was me.
Yeah, I think we were chatting about this
and
came to the realization. And yeah, then he just tripped across it in like a heart off somewhere. So thanks, Luke.
What happens?
Then the last one was a rental of Delicatessen.
Nice.
So yeah, I mean, of course you got to know French because it's not dubbed in English or subtitled or anything like that, but yeah. Wow. Yeah, so gold, let me see, gold can I pull it out? The kids are going to want to see the gold.
Yeah.
Yeah, baby.
Wow. Gold.
Yep. Yeah, when I had the top Obi, gotta have the top Obi.
I like that whole pig cover.
Yeah, it's pretty rad. It's fun.
What's the US cover of Delicatessen? Is that the pig
it's
too?
It's the little face that's on the back of that.
Is yeah, okay, okay. That
scary.
Little Dominique Pignon on the back there? That guy?
No, this the one that's in the lower.
Oh, you're right. Yeah, it's this one.
Yeah, that one, yeah.
Yes, yep.
It's that blown up huge. Which again is like one of those faces that like, I don't really feel like that's what's going to make me want to watch that movie. Like.
Yeah, it's just one of those things you can just kind of watch and then you're like, oh, that's what that's about. Or yeah. And then I went to the archive down in Bridgeport and they have a big Laserdisc section. So I got some store credit. I might as well get a couple Laserdiscs while I'm there.
Oh, yeah.
Including, this is not Letterboxd, but it's the theatrical cut, which the Criterion is not. Last Picture Show.
Nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh. Oh,
had to get this is actually a later like mid-90s reissue too, so yeah, had to grab that. And everyone's gonna be jealous, get ready, your favorite Jennifer Grey movie, Wind.
Ooh. Oh. Wind.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Wind.
It's actually a good movie.
I have not seen that.
Oh, there you go, you can watch Wind, check it out if you like boat racing.
Okay.
And who doesn't? All right, don't worry, Ryan. I got some cooler things coming up. I didn't have The Haunting on LD, so grab that.
It's a nice cover. Like that.
Which year did that come out?
60-something.
Hold on. OMD.
63.
It's a nice 90s reissue, though, right? Yeah.
93.
Yeah.
Yep. So there you go. Deluxe Letterbox. I told you I was going to have some MGMs in here.
Yes.
extended international version.
Yeah.
The minty copy of this kicking around at the bins. So I grabbed that.
Sorry. All right. Good movie. Really solid story.
Yeah. I mean, if you like space vampires, you're going to like this.
Naked space vampires.
Good point. That is a distinguishing factor.
Yeah.
Some OMDs. I know Spencer was showing this a couple of episodes ago, Knights of the Round. Yeah. So,
got that.
Yep. Top man. Yep. Got that.
I was trying to investigate the ones that he talks about because, you know, no one else really mentions these OMDs at such lengths. And sometimes he's very animated and they sound interesting enough to where I'll pull one off the shelf.
Yeah, this got the thumbs up, I think. So,
yeah.
And this one, I know my wife likes the story, so I really wanted to grab this too. I didn't have the picture of Dorian Gray.
Oh,
so
okay. Is that, there's like four pressings of that. Do we know if what pressing is good pressing?
I think this is good pressing. Okay. 90s pressing, so it's pretty sweet. It's got gatefold, even though it's just one disc.
Yeah.
Nice.
It's a good one.
Yeah, it's pretty badass. So this is nice.
Cool.
And I had this back in the day. I sold it. I had to get it back because it's no escape. I mean, it's one of my favorite movies. I mean, it's just all balls, all killer, no filler, man. No escape. So. And I had to get some Brone. I didn't have Vigilante yet.
Grab that one. Yeah.
So that was in the bins. Grab that. And for some reason, I always see this in lots, and it's always missing by the time I get to it. Hitchhikers, I wanted to grab.
Cool.
I got that one too.
Yeah.
Is that's the only pressing, right?
I do believe so. Yeah.
Yeah, there wasn't a UK one. No, there wasn't a PAL one.
And hold on, I'm almost done. Grab another stack.
Good pickups.
Yeah, almost done. And I'm still kind of going half-assed signature, and they had a sealed copy in 1941, so I grabbed that because I didn't have that yet. And then there was another guy, this jabroni in LDF was selling. All right, this jerk. All right. He's selling a couple discs because he's like, I'm getting out of LDs. And I was like, oh, you know.
Time?
Yeah. And I'm like, you know, I don't have that damn Star Trek box set, you know, with the movies. So I'm like, all right, I'll get the Star Trek box set. And he sends it to me and it's missing Generations. And then he puts this piece of crap in there instead. Oh. AC3 Lost Boys. Like, who wants this? Comment.
Is that Melanie Griffith from Body Double?
So, yeah, so I could finally knock this one off the list. And Ryan has actually seen this copy himself, so he'll probably...
in person, yep.
Yeah.
In person.
At the Indiana Film Society.
Wow. He probably licked it.
I did. It's got some good Haim. It's got some good Feldman.
Melanie Kiefer.
Oh,
good I'm Kiefer. Not, I mean, I tried to dress like Kiefer, like after I was out of my Travolta phase. In 87,
perfect.
I bought the jacket at the Army surplus store at the fair, walked around thinking I was like cool, like a Lost Boys character.
You were just too cool, Sam. It's just, you're getting cooler every time you tell these stories.
There was no Jamie Gertz on my shoulder. It was just like my parents walking around near me, but I was working it. I was working on it. Yeah. So there you go. So I got some Lost Boys finally.
I love it. That's so cool. That's a tough one. Yeah, that's serious.
Thanks. Yeah, oof. Because, yeah, there's one on eBay now for like $600. Not happening.
No one's going to buy that.
It's ex-rental, too. Screw that.
The one guy overpaid for his, and
yes,
everyone's like, oh, I'm jumping on that, and you can let it sit there for a couple of years.
Yep.
I think some jerk sold an ex-rental American Pirates, too. The Ferengi guy.
Oh, that'll be back in the Hot Topics. Don't worry.
Oh, the profiteer himself.
Yes, war profiteer. What do you got, Ryan?
I picked up some stuff. We're just gonna go over some foreign ones. We'll start out with this cool little thriller called Trust Me.
Oh,
it's Indonesian only. It was directed by a guy named Jeff Probst of Survivor fame.
Wow.
This isn't even on IMDb. Wow. So that's how you know it's good. If it didn't get to IMDb.
Whoa.
Trust me, it's good
quality. Yeah.
Are you Probst complete now?
Probably.
Probably.
Probst.
Moving on, we've got Overthrow. Nice. Wow. This is Hong Kong only. It's got a grenade here.
I love it.
Shit's going down.
with the D2 master, you know, high quality video.
Yeah, obviously. Keeping with the Hong Kong theme and D2 masters, Savage Attack.
Great.
Love it.
Yeah.
Great title.
This guy's in some movies. Final Round with Lorenzo Lamas.
Oh, nice.
Freaking legendary.
This is another Hong Kong, might be Hong Kong only.
Wow. Man. I want to see some of these back covers.
I didn't take the discs out. That's too much work. Yeah. I've got my Ken Shamrock Complete. Shamrock Complete Champions.
This is he wearing pants? Is that?
Do we need there? The
some bondage going on right there? Yeah. But yep.
It's like pumping iron level right here.
Yeah.
It's Indonesian only, and it's got the sweet Dolby Stereo digital.
Spectral recording, baby.
Oh.
You know, it's good. It's a hot item too. Like, in case you were wondering, hot.
That is freaking on fire hot right there.
Yep.
I might now be Dolph Lundgren complete with the Peacekeeper. This is like, I want to say Taiwan or something only.
He looks tired. Poor man.
He's like,
I'll show the Mac on this one so you can get some more Dolph.
I'll break you later.
Yes, I need more Dolph. Yes.
Ready to blast off.
Love Dolph. Love Dolph.
Yeah.
Got some sweet Tori Spelling.
Tori.
Wow.
Deadly Pursuits.
Amazing. Oh, Tori.
Yep. I think this, I don't even remember where this one's from. This might be Indonesian. It might be Singapore. It's one of the two.
Man, that's
crazy. Very, very common flick, obviously. Got some Sun Chaser.
Yes. Yes.
Or The Sun Chaser, I think, is the official title. Or
Breaking Bad, the original.
Yeah. Got some Woody. Moving on.
Jesse Pinkman, oh my God.
We've got Last Chance, a.k.a. Terminal Virus, with James Brolin and Brian Genesi of Broterian fame. Brian Genesi.
Man, Brolin almost looked like Mick Foley for a second.
Yeah.
Mick Foley and Brian Genesi. Yeah. Can't go wrong.
I love it. This is great.
Keeping with the quality, we've got Lone Tiger with Bruce Locke of, you know, that other movie with Bruce Locke.
Richard Lynch. He's spending some stuff at least. So.
Can't go wrong with Lynch.
Look at the photos on the back.
Whoa.
Selling you with the quality.
Blown out.
Boy.
Wow. I was
sleeping at the freaking photo hut that night.
It's 90s sepia. They must have 90s sepia.
And then we've got Billy Lone Bear with, you guessed it, Frank Stallone.
Frank.
Yes.
That's a good one.
Wow.
Hey. Moving on.
Oh, look at this jerk out on the beach.
Oh, we've got, hang on. We're gonna show everybody here. He's trying to connect to the audio, so we'll just make fun of him until he can figure out how to accept the audio button.
Yep.
Oh, man, that's
his ear flares.
Is it working? I don't know.
It's like talking to grandma on the FaceTime.
Yeah. I hope he's wearing a Speedo. He better be wearing a Speedo, Luke.
Hey, oh, there he is. Whoa. Yep. Hey. Who's that guy? Is he in Japan? Where is he?
Yeah.
Where is he? Where in the world is Luke?
The view's getting better.
Yep.
Yep.
He's got all his teeth, but we can't hear him.
Yeah. Where's the Luke audio?
There's water.
Luke, where are you?
Nope.
Yeah, we love you.
He's filming a good sequence right now.
We were flying along, and then Luke joined us, and saw teeth and
what
else is going on?
Let's just leave the Luke cam going for the rest of the episode. And
moving on. We've got the female reporter with you guessed it, Rothrock, aka Lady Reporter.
It looks like she's using a remote control. She's like, "I'm gonna change it."
Yeah.
To a lifetime.
Yes.
And a stick.
Oh, yes.
Because when the remote batteries are out, she has to use a stick.
Yeah.
That's Hong Kong only.
I'm going to watch Regis. Change the channel.
For those of you who are fans of the Cyborg Cop series, we've got David Bradley in Cyborg Cop 2.
Wow.
Not to be confused with Cyborg Cop 3, a.k.a. Terminal Impact.
Wow.
I was about to confuse it with that.
You're like, oh, man, there's fire and explosion in the government. Is that Cyborg Cop 3? No.
It could possibly be, but it's not.
Glad you taught me.
We've got a great combo of actors here. We've got Robert Davi and Matthias Hughes. Cyber Vengeance.
Wow.
Yeah. This is money. You've got like the best bad guy in every action movie, Matthias Hughes. You're just a beast. He always is the imposing dude who kills everyone except for the good guy at the end. Mm. But, you know, I don't want to, spoiler alert, I haven't seen this yet, but I'm assuming that he dies and Robert Davi saves the day.
That looks like a PC game. I think I just bought that for my, yeah.
Yeah.
And a
Hunter game 100%.
It runs on DOS, right?
Matthias Hughes plays Thor in this one. Oh, so watch out. He's going to kick some ass.
Have I think we it's determined IBM PC that... or compatible.
Yes.
Have we determined that cyber in the title is an automatic good film?
Yeah, automatic good 90s film. Yes. Like, name something after 1999 that has cyber in the title that's good.
Cyber Ninja. Yes.
Nope. No. It's just, that's like genre, though. They're harkening back, so it doesn't count. Yeah. Anyways, moving on. Deadly Target, PM Entertainment, Gary Daniels, and I believe this is Singapore only? Maybe
looks like he pooped out a cop lady or something. Did he poop her out?
He's just along for the, you know, butt ride. I don't know. The
butt ride. Yeah.
Not great placement. Yep. I mean, this is.
Yes.
Her firing is right in the crotch.
Like, what even? Yeah.
The intern made that cover, believe it or not.
I thought maybe there was like a little tiny, it was like Willow. Yeah, he had like a little tiny friend. He's like, hold on, I'll guard you. Hide under my butt.
All right, a couple more. We've got Danger in Paradise with, you guessed it,
Frank
Stallone. This is another one of those that I might be on IMDb, but barely, like, or it might not be. And I think this is Indonesian only because for some reason they got all the good movies that we didn't. Yeah. Like,
what the heck?
You got Frank Stallone, helicopters, and this chick.
I know.
I don't know if that's Karen Rowe or not. No idea.
Probably not.
And you got boats.
Yeah, yeah. And like, look at the back pictures. There's just like a dude and a chick, and he's not got a shirt on, so you know he means business.
Yes.
Yeah. Nope.
It's quality.
Couple more. We're almost done here. You've seen and heard of Snake Eater with Lorenzo Lamas,
yes,
right?
Yes, of course. Of course.
The thing they made Snake Eater 3.
Oh my gosh.
His Law.
Oof.
With Lorenzo Lamas. This is
who's on the bike? That guy looks fun.
Who is on the bike?
Yeah. It actually kind of looks like it looks. Oh yeah, it is. It is Bam Bam Bigelow.
Oh,
wow. The Bam Bam Bigelow.
Wow, this is legend.
Look at that.
Oh my lord!
Not to mention the chick he's talking to in the bottom corner. Like,
I mean, I was just looking at that.
Yeah,
some cheeks. There's like some old Marshall guy over there. He's looking badass.
But I mean, how many Bam Bam Bigelow movies are there?
I mean, this are one, you probably. Bam Bam
I believe I am Bam Bam and Frank Camera complete. And then last but not least, nobody move. Gridlock.
Ooh, Hasselhoff. Notice them.
The Hass.
Yeah.
Notice them.
Yeah.
Are you noticing them?
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
Is that the towers?
Are those, nobody move.
Better notice them.
Ooh.
From the producers of Clear and Present Danger?
Yeah, just as good. More Hoff.
Wow. More Hoff. So,
this is obviously Indonesian only.
This
is
plus
cover here. For those of you trying to be Indonesian complete and Hasselhoff complete, this right here checks both boxes.
Wow.
So get on that. But yeah, that's all I got. Lots of, you know, household films like Gridlock and Snake Eater 3 with Bam Bam Bigelow. And trust me, with Jeff Probst as director, that's the one you're looking for.
That's what I'm looking for.
Yep. Seth, have you gotten any laser discs?
Yeah, since your last time?
Raise the brow for us here, Seth.
Yeah, okay. I might, and I will lower it too. So I got a box of OMDs from Japan, like a random sort of lot, and here's one.
Yay! Nice.
My Fair Lady, and it is the Technidisc version, so it's not the shrinking AR.
And it doesn't look like potato, apparently.
Wow. Yeah, $300 right now.
Yep.
I should buy a copy before we air this.
I'll get you one. I probably have it.
All right, yeah.
Okay.
Hell yeah.
So, I don't know what this is. Gene Wilde? No. Who's this?
Gene Kelly.
Oh, Gene Funny Kelly. Face.
Funny Face.
Yeah. Who's the girl? Is that
that's Audrey Sabrina? Hepburn.
Yeah, it's Hepburn.
Yeah, Sabrina. Yeah, Audrey Hepburn. Yeah, okay, cool. Widescreen Paramount. 91. Yeah, could probably look
sweet.
Good. Yeah. So this, I bought like a lot of like US pressings from Japan. They take care of their stuff, so yeah. It's good.
That's the key. Yep.
In there, really long too. Yeah. I have this. I don't know what this is. Is it Brad Pitt?
Brad Pitt and the other guy there. I don't know why I forget his name.
Columbia pressing. So could this be a robber? I don't know.
It might be. Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah. Maybe it's DADC Austria. Yeah.
Yeah. Let's hope so.
Morpheus himself.
Yeah. Yeah.
And who plays Tina Turner in this one?
Angela Bassett.
Ah, cool.
Tita Turner.
Yep. Tita Turner. Yeah, that's good. I mean, yeah. It's intense, but it's good.
I mean, it's you gotta love Tita Turner.
Yeah.
Paper Moon. Yeah, with the signature on it and stuff.
Yeah, I think that's
the Bogdanovich.
I think that's the better pressing. Yeah. There's two pressings.
There is okay yeah, so this is probably a later release, like
yeah,
I believe so,
90s. Yep.
Yeah, he passed away recently and I haven't seen that one.
Yeah,
here we have Highbrow. This is like,
what are these? Oh,
Merchant Ivory. Yeah, are you a Merchant Ivory complete, Ryan?
He will be when I send him some.
I
definitely not.
I wonder, didn't the writer get like the Nobel Prize of something recently?
Wow, wow.
Yeah.
A boy.
Hey, nice.
Fonda. I saw this recently. This I didn't pick this out in a lot, as I said, but this is pretty decent. Yeah.
I saw that on antenna cable. Like,
I could tell.
Yeah. Or OMD musical. I think there's a musical. Goodbye, Mr. Chips.
Wow. Oh, yes, Mr. Chips.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a gatefold. Peter O'Toole and Petula Clark. What?
Yeah.
Did you just raid Spencer's pickups or are these yours?
Yeah.
OMDs are cool, man.
Involved in the other side of Laserdisc.
Okay. Streisand movie, Pioneer Special Edition.
Ooh, that's Ryan's favorite.
It's very sad.
Yeah. The way we were.
Streisand complete. Oh.
Some sort of Hong Kong action thing. I don't know. Is this
nice?
The crow? It's dad. His dad.
So. Yeah, crow dad. That crow was dad. The original title.
And really long lives too.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Soon.
Very long.
He was at least the crow had a good sequel.
Yeah.
Did it?
Yeah.
The crow. Are you this sure we saw the same movie? Ooh.
Oh yes, that's General best Kirk's pressing. Ass.
That this pressing is the one in the coupon.
Yeah, get that Hearts of Darkness.
Oh, you need your Hearts of Darkness.
I have it.
Okay, good.
And I think I have a couple of versions of this. This one is format in a format that the stupid DP.
Univisium.
Yeah, Univisium. Yeah, very good. Yeah. Yeah.
It is, yeah.
2.0, but it has an AC3 soundtrack, right?
Yeah. It does, and it rips.
Yeah, it rips.
Yeah.
Walter Murch.
Yes.
Great pickup.
Yeah. Passage to India, and yeah, I don't know, probably Pakistan. But this is a 166 movie, so does it really matter?
Well, yeah, because we just saw Vinny got the late release Passage of India, and that's the same framing. So,
oh my god,
they didn't bother to go letterbox at all.
Yeah. David Lean directed that one. This one, I was like, ooh, nice, but I don't think this is Pakistan, right?
Oh yeah, that might be Jabroni. Maybe, I don't know.
Yeah, it's you have to look, but they write it back here, but they have like a little square around it. It's presented in the matted.
Oh, okay, yeah.
No, I think that's the
but I guess that's a 166 too, so I don't think it's
European
trash.
Yeah. Damn Euro ratios.
Henry Fonda. I guess this is
wrong 56. Man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. Who's the woman? It looked like Ingrid Bergman, but it wasn't. No. So
Vera Miles,
like Academy Ratio.
Yeah, probably.
Oh, it's a Hitchcock. Oh, I didn't know.
Yeah, that one's a cool one.
Nice jacket too. That's cool looking.
Yeah, really nice. Yeah. All right. What else? Yeah, more David Lean, Dr. Zhivago.
Yes.
I think I have the box set, and I have some sort of AC3. The box set is AC3.
Yeah, they did a AC3 two disc too.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
That one. Right. This wasn't AC3, unfortunately.
I've got that one. That's a nice release, though.
Yeah. When is it released? Is it like 90s? 92?
It's 90s, yeah.
Yeah. All right. So Robert Redford out of Africa. And scan, right? Yeah. I don't know. Is there a widescreen release of this?
There's a signature, I believe.
Oh, wow. Really?
I think there's a signature collection. You could be wrong.
Okay. More.
I don't have it.
Yeah. More brand.
Ryan, look that up. Oh.
No. Yeah. So
controversial.
Yeah, I have the Criterion as well. So
yeah, I was going
to
say.
And here we have the Criterion cover on the inside here.
Oh yeah.
So, yeah. But yeah, I'm listening to a podcast now from the woman that does podcasts, and it's about erotic films, and they talked about this one, and they're also going to talk about Body Double too. So
excellent.
The Out of Africa signature was announced and canceled.
Oh, canceled.
The only Letterboxd release is the PAL French release.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's probably dubbed.
Yeah, version française. Yes.
Of course it is.
And have you seen the Tropic Thunder movie where they say don't go full retard, but I guess he does it in this one, Ryan's.
I've got that. Yep.
I haven't seen it actually, but it's David Lean, his last film.
Yeah, that's late Lean.
Yeah, and didn't go. No, he did this one.
It's not his last. That's 70s, no. Right?
Yeah, and then he did India.
Yeah,
I think. Yeah. Ooh. All right.
It's an autobiography.
Yeah, about Ryan Cushing.
Got some Haim. Both of them.
Whoa.
Yeah.
That's quality Haim.
Yeah. I like that when I buy like this sort of stuff and there's this inside. Like mixed in with them. Like,
so that's why you bought the lot, right?
Yeah,
of course. No, there's one of those lots where there's like they're quite hidden and obscured, and I'm not taking gamble, and there's junk in there and there's fun stuff in there. I mean, there were some fun stuff in there too.
Oh yeah.
I love license.
I mean, the Lord giveth and the DMV taketh away.
I felt that movie.
Hell yeah. I lived that movie.
I'm going to show some swag. I got one piece of swag. I have all stuff in the mail that should have already been here, but it's not.
Yeah.
So we have one piece of swag. We will have more. Let me get this right side up here.
I'm sensing a shirt or something. A towel?
Whoa.
Is that a beach towel?
It sure is.
Nice.
Wow.
I'm trying to get it in frame here. Have you seen the whole bit?
Damn.
Stripes? Am I showing it all?
Yeah.
Okay.
What was the target market for the Pioneer Stereo beach towel?
I mean, after you buy the Super Tuner, you probably get that.
There was some beach-themed bonanza going on in freaking Pioneer because there is this towel. I have another Pioneer towel. And I have the Pioneer Sun Visor that's this same logo. So they were like sending you out to the beach with your Pioneer radio.
Probably. I mean, yeah, you got the car with the T-tops off. You're driving to the beach. You got to have the towel.
Yep.
I got to make a custom Laserdisc bikini for this so I can have
the full setup.
I'm thinking all the Pioneer employee picnics were just at the beach. They're like, let's go to the beach this week.
Yes.
Hell yeah.
Thursday, Friday.
California. I mean, they were in freaking Carson City doing their freaking days. So.
Towels, frisbees.
I have frisbees. I have towels. I have visors.
Pioneer Beach Day.
Pioneer Beach Day all the way. I love that thing so much.
That's awesome.
The other towel I have. Oh, this actually, I should shout this out. I got this from a group member.
Oh.
I believe his dad, I have to look this up. If it's wrong, we'll have to put a little blurb. But I believe his dad had an association with Pioneer. I don't want
to. Oh, this sounds familiar. I think I saw something about that.
And he had hit me up like a long time ago. And I guess he's just now kind of getting to go through a bunch of stuff. So if there's anything more, I will, if I get something else interesting, then we will see. But this is the thing he sent me a photo of. And it's funny because I was, I don't know, the perspective of the photo when he said, you know, you're interested in this towel. And I was like, of course, love towels.
Yeah.
So like the perspective, it looked like the image was only like this big really on this big towel. Yeah. And like, it's huge. It's way different than what I thought. So
full beach towel.
Yeah.
Full now we need a walkie squawky one. Do you have a walkie squawky?
Gosh, I need that. I need that. If I find such a thing,
you'll be free. Oh, were you here when we invented walkie squawky?
Oh, yeah. No. Walkie squawky's the parrot.
Yeah. The karaoke parrot.
Yeah, karaoke parrot. We were
mad that he didn't have a name, so we just gave it to him.
Yeah, we gave him the walkie squawky. He had to have it.
I should make a puppet of him. That would be fun.
Yeah, him and Flippy the Turtle can hang out.
Yes. Yeah, but Flippy the Turtle is hard to animate.
Well, he's Flipside the Turtle when he's at the beach.
Ah.
What is this?
This is organized crime.
Yeah. Is that Lou Diamond?
I'm really not sure who all is in this. Let's see. Hoyt Axton.
No.
Yes.
Lou Diamond.
Lou Diamond. He's in here.
That looks like Herman Munster in the background. Is that Fred Gwynn?
You know what? I think that is Fred Gwynn. Yes, it is Fred Gwynn.
Is that Corbin Burnson? What the hell? What is this movie?
I don't know. It is Corbin Burnson. He called every one of these. It's incredible.
Yeah. Isn't it like a mafia, like crime comedy?
Comedy?
That's what I'm assuming based on this. I have no idea. I've not watched this yet. I'm really like, I just, the combination of this and this. I mean, you know, La Bamba on the cover, I was sold. So
yeah, that's epic. Is that like Touchstone or when they had that side banner? Jesus, stereo?
You are literally.
Yeah, I'm calling it.
That's just kidding.
There was that period where they always had that side banner on the front jacket.
Yeah. It looks a bit like a PAL sort of thing. They're like,
yeah, right? Yep. Yeah, it's R though, guys. It's R.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Whoa.
There's some gun business going on here.
Yeah, it's a crime intense. Comedy about a bank heist.
Ooh, okay. I think it looks good.
Yeah, it's a winner right there.
Okay. Oh, sorry. Let me get this dang ugly cover off of here. Ugh, big old sleeve. I don't like this. Okay.
Ooh.
The Break.
Martin Sheen.
It's all you need.
Pattons. It's a pioneer.
Yeah, this is a Sheen in here.
Wow.
I don't know.
I've never seen that.
Yeah, me neither. I just thought, you know, this is really what sold me down here.
Yeah.
I was like, what's happening? I want to know.
He wants to play tennis? Is that tennis racket?
I'm really like...
guessing that's his girlfriend that he's stealing.
Yeah. This is... We will see.
All right, report back. Whoa.
Ah, nice. Eric Roberts, you can't go wrong.
Can't go wrong. I was told this. I follow this rule.
Man, I'm guessing it's a cliffhanger, but better, right? Judging by the cover.
Yeah.
Yeah, because it's cliff.
He made it to Blockbuster first.
And he's got a gun while he's climbing that cliff. So.
Oh yeah, you have
no shirt, gun, Eric Roberts.
Gun sold. I got this crazy karaoke disc because it looks like, you know, ooh, one of my favorites. So.
Wow,
this guy, who knows what's on it?
That's awesome. Certainly
super best selection.
Nice.
Not just like the regular best.
Yeah.
Medium best.
It's no. Super best.
Super best.
Yeah, but this is a phobia, guys, because this don't come off.
Oh, I thought that was on. Oh,
isn't that crazy? It's freaking printed.
You fooled us with your phobia.
I know, it's a phobia.
They're just like, no, extra paper is too much.
Just print right on everything that might be a sticker. It's not. It's
on the jacket.
Yeah, it's all print.
That's what Super Best is all about.
Yes, Super Best. And there apparently was a correction because they had to paste over top of this. So.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. A lot of karaoke discs is like, especially the Japanese ones, it's like they paste it over something. Like
it's so funny. Yeah, there's like, there's something going on here. This is a paste over one.
We couldn't afford that song. We got this one.
Number nine. Yeah. No.
Remove it with a little hair dryer. Remove it with a hair dryer and peel it.
See, it's got the Beatles with dead babies.
Whoa.
That's a 60 minutes LD. Wow.
Right?
Volume one. Were there more?
I don't know.
How long is it?
Wait a minute.
More than an hour?
It's 62 minutes.
Ah. So there's a side break.
Yes.
My God.
Wow.
Is Morley safer on it?
I think I see him.
Yep.
Yep.
What's the guy with the eyebrows that all did like these sort of funny monologue.
So Ed Bauer in there? Oh yeah, and then what's his face? Yeah,
we have all the names here.
Mike Wallace, yeah. Yep. Morley, yeah. Safer.
Eraser, no, Ed Bradley, and no, he's missing. What the hell is
Andy
his name?
Andy something, right?
Yeah. Fuck. Yeah. It'll come to me. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it would sound like this.
Yeah.
This yeah. is I believe an 84 pressing.
Wow.
But it kind of has that like more modern looking cover to me. I don't know.
Yeah. That's impressive.
We will see. We'll see. I have Cactus Flower. This was one that I had just really have seen a lot of clips from it. Mm-hmm. And I think this is what I'm thinking of. This has dancing or something in it that I like, mm-hmm. that I wanted to see more of. So I got that one.
It's an award winner.
Is it? Oh my gosh,
yeah, it says something.
1969. What? It's Walter Matthews and Goldie Hawn. I think it's Goldie
Hawn. Oh, nice.
Whoa. That's an early film for her, right?
Yeah, I think it says introducing Goldie Hawn. So I believe
it's the
first one. Nice.
Okay. She was probably like doing Laughing at the time or something.
Yeah.
Nice.
I'm filling in the holes in my Van Damme collection.
I need that too.
Do you?
Yeah, I do. I gotta get one. Yeah.
I'll check if I have more than one. You never know. I have lots of Van Damme around.
He does get around.
Claw. Okay. Obsessed.
Really?
I've never seen this cover.
A lot of quotes on the front.
Yeah.
Could be good.
Keeps you on the edge of your seat from start to finish. Los Angeles Times.
That's a real newspaper.
That's a real freaking newspaper.
Sorry, new.
Nerve fraying psychological battle. That is it's Alan Thicke. So that's really what sold me.
So it's going to be better than De Palma.
TV movie.
Yeah.
Oh, TV movie, of course.
Of course, yeah. It's freaking made for TV movie. It's a freaking after school special. Yeah, probably.
It's got Saul Rubinek. Can't go wrong with Saul Rubinek.
Oh, goodness. Is he? Yes, he's on the front here.
We'll do a Saul Rubinek cast after the Luis Guzman one.
Oh, yeah.
I heard, is this one set in 2022, or did I get that?
Oh, is it? I haven't seen that in ages.
It's a killer ride.
I probably saw it in 97 or 98 when it came out, but.
I'm pretty sure this is the one. I wrote down one to grab. That hopefully this is it, but I wrote down one to grab because it was set in 2022 and it was Ray Liotta. Oh no, I got it wrong.
Unforgettable?
It's Noah Spade.
Oh,
the one you showed, and I had it in my head as Turbulence. Oh my gosh,
2022, right. Baby.
Good one to pick up.
2022. I'll keep Turbulence, but I'm grabbing No Escape now. I have to go dig for it. When I was digging for all my De Palmas, I had to I came across some things. I was like, oh man, is it this one I'm looking for? But go look.
Oh yeah. Got some victory.
Yeah. I was confused by Michael Caine in this. I felt like this cover.
Stealth widescreen.
Yeah, stealth widescreen. It's there.
Oh yeah. That's the is that a soccer movie?
Yeah.
Is it rugby?
Yes, it is, because Pele's in it.
Yes.
Yeah, Pele. Okay.
Soccer match, yes.
Yeah. Max Van Sydow's in there too.
All the big soccer movies of our time.
Yeah, Pele's in it.
Yeah, but it's interesting. So I got the Japanese one in a lot well back, and it's like soccer movie with Stallone. It's like, what?
I know. The Stallone of it is what sold me, and then I was like, I'm gonna see what that's about.
I think it's a scope film, right?
Oh,
so it needs to be widescreen.
Yeah.
I'll show a little small guys.
Ooh, what do we got? Oh, hell yeah.
Nice.
There is a record of that, a single coming out tomorrow for Record Store Day. Damn, Minor Detail. I've never seen that 8-inch ever.
Here. You got three songs on here.
Wow.
And I've never seen that one. Naked Eyes, I had.
Nice.
Before, but it got. I've had a bad cover incident. We'll just say that.
Oh yeah, I need too. Yeah.
Okay.
That's a great album.
This may end up on your shelf, Sam.
Oh hell yeah!
So which videos is on that one?
Probably Pale Shelter, Mad World, and Change.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, Pale Shelter.
Hell yeah.
But I think that's good enough. I'll keep it.
All right, cool.
I'll have more good stuff next time when my friggin' stuff shows up.
All right, you guys ready for some hot topics?
Yeah, bring them.
We got some heaters this time.
Right. Ooh.
First up is one that we had a lot of fun with. The LDDB added something to the useless statistics, which is IMDb ratings. It tells you the highest and lowest of the IMDb user ratings out of all your films that you own in your collection. And then if you want to go through and poke through your collection, it'll actually have the individual rating for each one there. So you can pinpoint which one sucks and which one doesn't. So thanks to Ryan, I think my lowest was the whatever werewolf was, which is like 1.6.
1.6, yeah.
Out of 10.
Yeah, you got almost two.
My lowest was Leonard Part 6. And I'm like, fuck, I didn't add werewolf. Thanks, Ryan.
You're like, fuck, I have Leonard Part 6 as the lowest. Let's see if I can beat it.
Wait. Enter Tony Zarendast.
Is it on the I didn't get my score. I want my score. Where do I find
check, yeah, check out your go to your
I'm on my account. I got it.
Yeah, and then your useless stats with all the dead sides.
Go
and
into your
in
collection, but don't click into anything beyond that. Oh. Useless stats, yeah. It's beautiful. It's like the best new feature.
It should have like a little IMDb ticket logo.
Useless statistics.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, my lowest is 1.6 also.
I don't think anyone has anything below that. I think that is the lowest. Like,
oh my god.
What it might be the fourth.
Oh my gosh. Can I how do I find out what it is?
If you go through your
it's werewolf.
You have werewolf into your collection.
Yeah, it's werewolf.
If you go into your collection, there's an actual ratings field and you can click on that and it should order them.
Oh my gosh. Okay. All right. I'm doing this now. We're
and the top is usually the Godfather box set, the 1901 to 1980. Oh. And Shawshank.
And
Yanni Live at the Acropolis, all 9.3s.
Sort it by rating.
Shredding with Yanni at 9.3.
So my highest rated is for those about to rock.
That's high.
Metallica, Black Crowes, Pantera.
Yep.
And then let's take a peek here of my.
There was a lot of music videos in the top. I was actually surprised.
No Yanni though, man.
Yeah.
Sounds like Maxine needs a Yanni.
Oh well, yeah. Okay. My. I have a lot that haven't been rated because I have a ridiculous quantity of discs that no one else has, and unless I've given it a rating.
We know there are 10 in our hearts, but yes.
There are all these, you know. Pre-production ones. Okay, hold on. I have to really go. We'll come back to me. I'll tell you.
Yeah, like the last like couple pages of my list.
Oh my god, it's werewolf. It literally is werewolf.
Of course it is. It's always werewolf. Like, we have found the bottom and it did not take long.
And it's werewolf, yeah.
Okay. What's literally right above that is Nuki though.
Oh well, yeah, I mean obviously, but you know,
yeah. Werewolf. And, the only slightly higher than that I have is Iga, which is 2.2.
Oh,
the only one higher, I think Yorma had a 9.4 or 9.5. No, he had a 9.5. And I think it was just another Godfather pressing, but it was like just one of the movies.
Well, I'll just rate something that I don't have by myself. Yeah. So that it'll be a 10 and then I'll have a 10. Yeah.
You got to make sure that like IMDb has enough ratings for it to count though. Like it's got to have like so many.
Yeah. You got to get some bots to help.
You got to get like Seth and I to also rate it. We can game the system.
Pioneer Plus and Clan Tour.
That was it was the Japanese box that had the 1901 to 1950 something without part three. That was a 9.5.
Oh.
And then one of the other guys had a 9.4. I think it might have been another music or opera disc or something like that. Wow. Yeah.
Damn.
Howling 7 is a 1.8.
Oh my gosh.
And then Going Overboard is a 1.8. So if you're looking for the bottom, you've got Going Overboard, which is easy to find.
Yes.
Howling 7, which is not, Nuki, which is not, and Werewolf, which kind of is. So you can go right to the bottom.
Really. Yes. What was your average? Did you get over 7? Or?
Oh, let me go back to that. I will let you know.
I was like 6.9 something.
I know what my average is.
Mine was not as high.
I love useless stats.
I added a Citizen Kane I forgot about, and then added Werewolf, and they like canceled each other out.
Congratulations, you moved 0.
I stayed where I was.
I've got 7.13.
My average is 6.04.
Yeah.
5.94.
Oh yeah. So all day Vinny was strutting his stuff, saying like, yeah, this shows you who's got taste. I'm like, yeah, taste according to some jabronis on, you know, IMDb.
I like IMDb though. I feel like the jabronis on IMDb give good, accurate representation of films. So
yeah, we were just trying to.
Well, Mookie's a little higher. It's at least $16,000
higher. It's definitely higher than Werewolf. We know that.
Yeah. I got Leonard Part 6. Leonard Part 6, a Japanese prison with an Obi.
That adds at least 0.1, right?
Yeah, the Obi does. So there you go, kids. Have fun with that. That's like a good afternoon of entertainment.
I like that.
Right there. What movie did you guys watch on 420? That was like a big poll in LDF.
Oh, actually, movies. What did I watch?
I suggested Poltergeist because the parents are smoking doob in one scene, but yeah. Oh. Yeah.
I watched Silver Streak.
Right? I think I just watched some De Palma.
I went to sleep.
I watched Silver Streak on
YouTube. Silver Streak rocks. What do you watch, Seth? Phantom Menace?
Phantom of Paradise.
Yes.
It's the same movie.
This is good.
420.
Yeah. Two Phantoms.
Yeah.
Right.
And
do you guys play the Framed game?
Yes.
Yeah. So
because of you, it's your fault. You brought it to us.
What's the Framed game?
It's like Wordle,
but for movies.
Yeah.
Oh.
You get one.
No.
Yeah, you get one frame from a movie.
Have you read any chats in the past month?
Look it. I mean, we've had a discussion about what's going on in my life. So, no, unfortunately, I haven't read any chats.
Ryan.
Freaking things.
You get a frame. You try and guess it. You have six guesses, six different frames. It gets easier theoretically every time.
Yeah. Wow. On 420, they had the Pineapple Express, and if you wouldn't know your drug paraphernalia thing, you would have got And they took me a couple of hours.
Was it a cross joint?
No, they didn't. Oh, that would have been easy. It took me three guesses to get it. Yeah.
What did they show?
The first one was
ashtray.
The second one was the cop car flipped over on its side.
Okay.
But it looks like something out of Dark Blue, out of context. You know, you're like, oh, it's an action movie or something. Yeah. And then the third was Seth Rogen coming down the stairs after serving someone in one scene. But he's like kind of far away.
Yeah.
But you could just see his like hair and you're like, that looks like Seth Rogen from, oh, it's Pineapple Express. Oh,
I would know. I saw Seth Rogen. So.
Yeah. Like you shop with him now.
I know.
Shopping buddies. So there you go. That's a hot tech. Oh, what else? I know we had some other good super big ones in here. Vinny destroyed the community with his predatory pricing on American Pie and Spy of Shagney discs.
I honestly was so confused. I saw these posts. People are like hating on these prices, but yet everyone has paid those prices.
He sold them
both. I'm very confused by it.
Yes. Ryan tried to explain it to him, but everyone has to make a kind of show of how offended they are in public. But then behind closed doors, they're watching Body Double and they're buying things on eBay for high prices.
Literally don't even offer it up to LDF if you want to get what it's worth. Throw it on eBay, pay the fees, and you'll still beat whatever your shittiest best offer on LDF is. They don't want to pay for it on LDF. They want to bargain.
Kudos. If you sell it on LDF, then they can buy it and say, oh, I just got this. And then they will sell it again later.
Well, if you don't buy and sell the same six discs over and over again.
That was another one. One guy saw someone else flipping one of his discs that he sold pretty cheap, and that turned into a bit of a brouhaha. What disc was it? It was something fairly rare, right?
It was Dirty Work.
Mm. Yeah, but there was another one too, I think, in there. And like, yeah, so he's like, what the hell, bro? I sold that to you for like a couple bucks.
Yeah, $4. And literally... he buys it off a guy in the group and then resells it in the same exact group for like 200. It's like
tough.
Biggest that's douche cool. move you can do. If you're going to sell something like that, literally eBay. No one knows who you are on eBay. If you really want to do it, like just don't eat. Like, you know, shit where you eat.
That's a salt in the wound kind of thing. That's pretty rare.
Yeah. The guy was like pretty sad about it too. You could tell. He was just like,
Dick move.
That guy.
Of course, to break the rule that Ryan just explained, Peter's been having a fire sale and he's been raking in the dough hand over fist in LDF. 5 years ago, Peter would have talked about buying a $100 disc and people would have gotten pitchforks to chase him out of town. Now that they're lining up to buy like all his high-end discs.
Yep. He's like completely out or almost.
Is he fully out? I just don't believe it.
He says he's Criterion. He's saving the Criterions. That's what he says.
Like until he buys something else and is like, I want the Criterion space. That Calyx is going to have zero LDs in it. It's going to be like records and whatever else. That's it.
What is he reusing his freaking retro tank for then?
He
sold that already.
he sold it
like, right away. Yeah. Once it didn't work for anything, he's just like, fuck this.
It was gone.
So what is he watching? Like, what is he actually watching?
4Ks.
Yeah, 4Ks. Yeah.
He watched that Lost Boys. We watched it at LaserCon 2022.
Hell yeah.
How'd it look at the Peter rig?
Yeah. It's not as good as it should be for a late release AC3, but the sound's smoking and you've got two quarries, so you don't even care.
Sure. Yeah. But I mean, like, how was Peter's rig?
Oh no, you got to see it. Gorgeous.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong. Like his setup, gorgeous.
Wow.
It's still Laserdisc. So like, you know, you're only gonna get so far. And if, you know, unless you're watching Mission Impossible every time, you're starting with some pretty rough source.
Did he show you some 4Ks on the Mad VR?
He threw on some 4K. It smokes. The sound is ridiculous. Shake the house, the neighborhood. We had two different LaserDisc group admins in the same room.
Yeah, that was like a full LaserCon.
Yeah, it was. There were six of us there.
That's rad.
Six dudes in a basement watching two quarries.
Hell yeah! That
sounds like what do you want?
Free time.
Yeah.
I was hoping Luke would be here for this, but I know our Brody Malcolm in LDF almost quit for like a day and called Luke Dick Lips in the process because pissed him off.
Well deserved.
So I was hoping to get Dick Lips here to like have a chat about that, but of course he's still on the beach. Yeah.
Dick Lips is on the beach. So
with his pioneer towel.
Yeah, I know. He wishes whatever. He had a pioneer towel in Japan right now.
Yeah. He's got something like not cool at all.
Malcolm might have posted like six times in a day and Luke's like, we didn't need to know that. And then
he just dunked on him.
Okay.
So like, you know.
Still. That was good. What else? We had a great day when Altman showed his Fantasia collection, which started Fantasia Bump Fest.
So much good Fantasia content.
Oh my gosh. I have something I need to send him. It's Fantasia related.
Good old Wizard Mouse.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a Wizard Mouse item for him.
Shout out to Wizard Mouse.
Like, my entire feed was all Wizard Mouse that night.
Literally, there's so many Wizard Mouse tags. Like, it's just beautiful. And then Mikey was getting tagged because of it.
Yeah. I think we tagged Garth Tiffin. Shout out to Garth. Yep. Think you're out, but if you're still in LDF, we'll tag you eventually.
Yes.
Especially if Fantasia comes around.
We got Grail Watch. You guys ready for the new Grail Watch list?
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Let's hear it.
All right. Since last episode, Hot Grails, American History X, Dragon's Lair Cabinet. It's a Grail.
Yeah.
Babylon 5, complete.
Fair.
Doesn't exist.
Now, by Babylon 5 complete, you're like...
Yeah. Everything that was released, but not all the episodes. Yeah,
and like there's an entire season missing. Like, season one, half a season two, and then half a season four.
I got in, and then I realized that, and I'm like, you know, I'll just keep the Japanese copy of the pilot and call it a day.
Yeah,
yeah. So there you go. And the last Grail was Trevor mentioned Fudge Squad. So,
really tough find, guys. I don't know.
Yeah, can't be.
True Grail.
Moonbeam complete without Fudge Squad.
It's impossible to come by.
New market technique. Jen and the group decided to start selling bags of packing material for $5 a pop and realized it's a hot commodity on Facebook Marketplace. So
that's crazy.
Get out there and hustle that.
It's cheaper than buying it in store.
Yeah.
You got it.
Bag it up and sell it.
Yep.
What else? Component outputs on DVLs still don't work for LD except for black and white. Just to let you know.
Oh man. Yeah. What about RGB SCART?
Nope. Nothing.
God damn it.
Yeah, sorry, buddy.
Fucking DVLs. Man, like one of these days we're gonna crack playing DVDs.
Maybe. I don't know. And what else? Oh yeah, also Netflix is tanking, so save your laser discs.
I'm glad that I have Stranger Things on Laserdisc.
Laserdisc, yeah.
What else? Orange
Cobra Kai. You got Cobra Kai on Laserdisc, right?
Yeah, of course I do. Yeah. So these services will never make it because we have all the good stuff on discs. Yeah. So and they will also, if it's not made in the LD era, they will release on Blu-ray just after the show has aired. Yeah. Have you seen the two popes on DVD?
Yeah. Nope.
No, it's easy. I think if there's a screener available or something. So you can have it, Sam.
Yay. What else? Remus got in the group got fired up about misspelling Laserdisc in the Laserdisc group when it's actually in the header. Yeah.
You know what? So, spell how you want.
Yeah. I mean, if you're going to spell it correctly,
and though, a Z in there, I think.
Capital L, capital D. Make sure you don't mess that up.
Yes, I'm gonna go to my local record store tomorrow and say you've put an like a hyphen.
That's, yeah, that's, don't do that.
No. I'm gonna tell him off.
That's where I'll draw the line.
Dude, like don't
shit on his counter.
Straight up.
Boom. Go full Amber Heard.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Wow, hot topics here. Look at you. Celebrity gossip, Seth.
Ooh. Seth's celebrity gossip corner.
Yeah. And of course I saved the best for last.
Oh my god.
The hottest news since the last podcast was the golden tickets.
Yes.
Willy Wonka 2. Willy Wonka happened in real life, everybody, in the Pacific Northwest.
Man, those water damage discs for like $80. Yeah. Just gotta take them.
Oh my god.
Water damage old man discs. Whew.
For someone who
Fantasia has a box. There was a Fantasia box.
There was.
There might be chocolate on it. And it went for $90 retail. So
I mean, still a bargain. Last November, someone had posted that they had a lot. Maybe 3,000 discs. The number kept changing every time.
Yes.
Had some photos. I saw a lot of damaged covers, and then some like stuff. And then it went away. And then recently there was an offer in LDF that someone was buying the lot and you could go along if you won the golden ticket. There were only three available, and that offered you the opportunity to take the ones that the buyer didn't want to keep. And then they were going to like flip them on the spot maybe, and then raise the prices. I don't know. Figure out the prices as they went. You were going to get a deal as long as it was something that wasn't like in stock in the store. So I don't know. And then, yeah, so one person went, like two people were going to go, one person bailed, and one person went, and they got a lot of stuff.
Shit. But,
yeah.
I mean, and the cool thing is like, if you join and then you get five of your friends to join, then you might, you know, move your way up.
Well,
try and recruit five of their friends.
Ooh.
So it got weird in the group because there was a lot of people complaining about are like bad attitudes about it, but you're like, well, this was a public post and it was kind of presented in a way that brought up a lot of questions. So
it was shady as shit.
It was formerly available for anyone in the same
anyone
group to buy the whole lot, some of them
publicly.
Any situation of you could go to this person yourself without needing any middleman or anything like that and buy these.
Jeez.
And then it's very strange. It was strange. I was confused.
And it wasn't just you can come and have some of them. It was you won a golden ticket.
Yeah.
You know, to have this opportunity of a lifetime.
Yep.
To take the discs that I don't want.
They had already probably been gone through by like six or seven other people since.
Yes.
I mean, I think they
October?
Were.
October?
Yeah.
Yes. Because there were people that said that they were interested back in the day. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it was skimmed. So,
you and won a golden ticket to go to the factory and become an Oompa Loompa, basically, to do hard labor.
And it was like in the terms that you had to agree up front to buy an indeterminate large amount of discs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At prices that weren't advertised.
Yes.
Yeah. It was.
They were going to be cheap and or expensive if they were hot ticket items.
So, like, here's the deal. If it was like you show up, you're going to get a couple of cases of cheap, cool discs.
Yeah.
Doesn't even have to be cool. Just show up and help me move shit. Everyone would be like, hell, this is awesome. Not yeah, like yeah. show up, move shit, and then pay to keep a couple things. Fuck.
It was
that.
Pay to play. It was total pay to play.
Oh yeah, it was the shadiest, like skeeziest finder's fee bullshit I've ever seen.
And it was like the thing that really was confusing to me is I went back and found the freaking yes. original post. They were like $1 each or less yes. when mm. if you were to buy something. So that was not going to be the price.
Yeah.
For someone else to go in and buy that.
Yeah.
And that's where it's like this is confusing. Like what is someone doing that?
Yeah, and Vinny even was like, are we like flipping the discs on the spot of the original owner? You're like, oh, here's
while the owner's there, like
here's yeah, a couple hundred there. Bucks, but for you, 10,000. Yeah.
So strange. I've yeah. never heard of such a thing like that. Like
those words skeezy.
But yeah, like Ryan said, you could be like, look, I can't bring all these back. If someone wants to come and help me, just yeah, you'll get a bunch of discs. Yeah.
Bring 5 empty crates. We'll come yeah. up with something. Yeah. All day, but no. It's just like, you've won the right to help me by doing lots of labor to buy stuff that I don't want.
Then on top of that, the water damage discs came in. And
oh, yeah.
They haggled over the water damage discs.
They haggled over dumping garbage, yes. literally, because they were water damaged common shit. Not
and
like
the guy was like, I will take these off your hands. Yeah.
Oh, we got it. We got to drop in.
Let's see.
Is it
find out if he got
it. It might be dick lips.
See.
Oh.
Oh, 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 oh.
What do we got?
Oh, 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 oh. Ooh.
We might be in luck.
Oh my
did
gosh,
you get
are
the
you
golden ticket?
It's the golden ticket winner. Check it in.
Yeah.
Luke, we heard you got a nickname.
Yeah, tell us about Dick Lips.
Dick Lips.
Okay, see you guys later.
Yeah, we were telling about how Malcolm called you Dick Lips because you offended him. So.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that. I don't care.
You mean you lost sleep about it.
People.
Yeah.
Oh.
Oh, here we got a visitor. Hello.
Hi.
Jake.
Hi.
Did you both get to go to the beach or was it just Daddy going to the beach?
No, it was both of us.
Excellent. Yeah,
we have a favorite spot where we throw rocks.
Yeah. The zoo was closed.
Look what Max got.
Whoa, is that a towel?
Pioneer towel.
Wow, cool.
Yeah.
You needed it at the beach.
So yeah. You didn't get the golden ticket, though?
Yeah, you didn't get the golden? Yeah.
I love the red.
Oh, Max, she loves the red.
Oh, thank you.
So, yeah. Max is the most stylish. Seth is second most stylish.
Yeah.
Yeah. Look, he's got a...
Oh, is it Doctor Who?
We've got that in the bedroom. We've got a phone booth. We've had that toy, right? Yeah, say, I like your shirt.
I like your shirt.
Uh-huh.
Aww. It's a Doctor Who phone booth.
Everybody likes Seth.
Phone booth, please booth.
What do you got, Ryan? What are you wearing?
Iron Man.
What has he got?
Oh, Iron Man would be cool.
Don't give
me any static. Yeah.
And we're
going to Spider-Man shots.
Oh, Ren's wearing her. Yeah, say.
Ooh, you got a Spider-Man shirt?
Oh,
where
cool.
Where did you get that shirt?
From Japan.
Nice.
Excellent.
Oh.
I just got a Hawaiian shirt.
Ooh, Hawaiian
nice.
Shirt.
Yeah, that's
Hawaiian.
Yeah.
Cool. So we like everybody's shirt, maybe not Ryan's. Who's doing it?
Standard.
This one.
That one, Seth. We like his shirt. Yeah.
Maxine's probably the winner.
Maxine, we like her shirt.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Cool. And she got earring. Oh, and
well, I'll have to make your girl a pair.
That is cool.
Yeah. We're pointing to who we like on the screen.
Oh, yeah, it's the Hollywood Squares.
Pointing at right now. Mm-hmm.
Excellent, thank you. Mm. Thanks for your vote.
The bearded guy. Do we like his?
Yeah.
So that's everybody.
Yeah.
We totally hijacks. It's now the Ren show.
That's cool.
Okay.
Did you have any hot topics you want to discuss, Luke?
Nope. Yeah, cool. I can take just your shirts.
Yeah, we were just wrapping up, so that's we're going into the.
You.
Well, we're going to the pickups for non-LD stuff, if you have any.
I do. I have one.
All right, cool. Well, I'll start, and then we'll get back to you if you want to hang out. Yeah. Cool. I'll
put it on me.
Boom. All right. I don't have too many things. I got a few records. One just came in the mail today from a friendly Japanese visitor who is now in San Diego. But Luke sent me a rental record of Duran Duran, A View to a Kill, which is
a rental 45, cool. Right?
Yeah. So I guess, you know,
renting a 45.
You can't afford to buy A View to a Kill, so you roll in and you rent it. Oh. I don't know how much it costs. Yeah. Hopefully rental record.
Pay to play.
That is too cool. So yeah, Luke wins for finding that.
That's super cool. Love that song too.
Yep. What else do I got? Oh, he also sent me James Bond's Spy Who Loved Me on record. Mm. Yep. Got some fun stuff in there. And great old 80s stuff. McAlpine, Aldridge, Rock, Sarzo, Mars, Project Driver. This was like classic. Was this Shrapnel Records? All right. This was like good, like shredding stuff back in the day. So these guys know how to party. So
they look like it.
Yeah. Good guitar stuff. Uh-oh. This one's Hide the Children's Eyes. This is creepy. Don't look. It's a band called Horrendous. I got that.
Wow.
Yeah. Sorry. And I went to the archive and got some Blu-rays as well as LaserDiscs. Including Get Crazy.
Nice.
You like Phantom of the Paradise? You might like Get Crazy too. Same director as Rock and Roll High School. Fantastic film with Malcolm McDowell. Daniel Stern, yep. And Lou Reed in it is fantastic. Yeah, so good. So psyched to have that. And I think this is the last thing. Had to get the Shaw Scope Arrow box set, which is a gorgeous set with 10 discs, also some CDs in here as well, but old classic kung fu films. Very, very gorgeous, kind of like digibook thing in here. Yeah, it's got the martial arts forms in there. It's got the kind of like flip thing with the Criterion does it sometimes. You just kind of stick the discs in there. So, but yeah, it's got cool artwork and stuff. Yeah, Chinatown Kid. And it does have a sweet book as well in there too. So the Shaw Scope set is fantastic. Volume 2 is coming out this year, I believe, at some point. So I can't wait to get that as well.
That's so cool.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
It's a good pickup.
Yeah.
Way to go. You spent your money wisely.
I know, right? Now it's Ryan's turn. Go.
Yep. All right. I got some Dollar Tree stuff because, you know, you can't go wrong for dollar items. So here we go. We're going to blow through these. Got Evil Takes Root with slipcover DVD. I don't even know what this is, but the cover is awesome.
So the artwork's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's enough for me to buy it for a dollar.
Yeah.
The Mario Bros. Mix, limited edition.
Wow.
I believe. Nope. Cookie jar. I don't know.
You're just saying words now.
No, that's the publisher on the spine. It says cookie jar.
Oh,
don't ask me. Cool. I was like, maybe it's like Shout or something. No.
Cookie jar. Ren likes that one.
Rockzilla includes four bonus movies. Wow. It's got Attack of the Giant Leeches, Piranha from, I'm not sure which Piranha, it doesn't say.
Not the good
that's
one.
That's how you know.
Yeah.
Voyage to the Prehistoric Planet and the Killer Shrews.
Oh, yeah. Public domain.
Hey, you had me a Prehistoric Planet, so.
Yeah.
Nope. Deadlands, you can get this off Vudu.
Wow. Nice. Exclusive.
Painted Woman with two bonus movies, which are Kid Vengeance and Little Rita.
Okay.
Bring in the Jurassic Thunder.
Yes.
Oh, nice.
Yes.
And some Blu-rays. I Know Who Killed Me with
Lohan. Oh, yeah, I remember that.
I'm sure it's good.
Lindsay Lohan, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, my God. It's got Lohan?
Yeah. Yeah. Star Trek 8?
It's not good.
It's probably not. You are right. The good one?
That's nice, yeah. What's the backside of that? Does it have the yellow UPC or the white UPC?
Yellow.
That might be the bad one. Yeah.
Oh, can't remember. It was a dollar.
This is like a they reissued it because they fixed it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Monsterland?
There's a sticker on this one, so I don't know.
And then I got a few other things that are not a dollar that I picked up. It's at Half Price Books, and they had some highbrow, so I picked up Devil Hunter and Cannibal Terror. That's Jess Franco's Devil Hunter, so you know it's good.
Jess Franco's, yeah, quality.
And they had Escape from Women's Prison from Severin. You know, these are good selections at Half Price Books that you go in and you're like, hey. There was a sale on that one digital bookstore slash everything else. Random Acts of Violence. It was like $6 new, shipped.
Nice.
Picked up Trapped Alive from Arrow.
Oh, that's cool.
And then one more Blu-ray, the complete Leprechaun collection, which all of them were on sale for $10, all seven of them. So,
oh my gosh.
Yeah, talk about a deal. And then I got some records. So.
Okay.
Again, I should not pay attention to Amazon sales. I picked up the new Less Than Jake because it was $12. So cool. And it's the pink vinyl.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Moving right along. I got this from a guy who went to Japan. It's the Fat Obi Men at Work. You cannot go wrong.
That's good.
That's good.
Yes.
This is a gorgeous looking album, too. Like, just great.
The original white.
Yep. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. The yellow is the reissue, right?
Yeah.
The like American version.
American.
Jabroni version.
Yeah.
Who can it be now? It's a good song.
Well, keep rolling. I don't know. Are these guys any good? The Killing Joke?
Ooh, yeah. So that's like one of their toughest, that's like a tough entryway album though, because it's like pretty intense and raw.
Nice. And then I picked this up. It looked cool. It's called Sunblind Lion by Observer. Ooh. It's like a Illinois private press psych.
Man.
No idea. It's even got the original like lyric insert from back in the day.
Cool.
It's really cool looking.
Yeah, and, look at that art. That's cool.
Let's see, where's it from? Oh, sorry, Plymouth, Wisconsin. Plymouth, Ooh. Wisconsin, you know, Wisconsin private press psych, you know.
Yeah.
And then there's this band called Stabbing Westward, and they came out with a new album for the first time in like 20 plus years.
Wow.
Chasing Ghosts.
Neat.
I haven't opened it yet, but I got two just in case it's good.
Just in case.
Yeah. I'm going to pay shipping. I might as well pay shipping for two. Yeah. And then there's this band. They like are famous because for some reason a bunch of old dudes like bought their album and knocked Taylor Swift off number one.
Oh,
Tool?
I don't know if you've heard
of them. Did a box set come out
with like etchings on every disc, right?
It's nice. Five discs, and every other side has an etching. So like it's the most inconvenient way to listen to music. So me, like most other people who like to actually listen to music,
bought
like,
two.
You know what? Let's just get the bootleg.
Yeah.
So this is just a double vinyl, and there's no etchings or anything. It's just the album, so you can listen to it. So yeah, but those are my pickups. Not didn't go too crazy this time, and the Jabronis at FedEx couldn't deliver my monthly subscription on time. So
yeah, Vincent was missing, huh?
Yep. Sorry, Vinegar Syndrome. Yep. You guys need to get a better shipper.
Yeah, what the heck?
Maxine?
Oh, man.
I actually am so prepared right now. This is insane.
You got some stuff.
A dang stack of DVDs.
I thought I saw you run in to get some DVDs.
I was like, I'm prepared. I just didn't bring them over here. So I have Galaxy Quest.
Yes.
Ooh. Yes.
What a great bringing movie. Oh my gosh. Yeah. I saw this recently and was just like, holds up still.
So. Good that special
should,
features.
Honestly, this really should have been on Laserdisc.
I'd love to have it. It would have been
$99,000. Like,
does the DVD have the correct AR, Sam? Do you know this?
It's missing one. It's got two of the changes. Yeah, but it's not the theatrical change. But I don't think it has been released properly yet.
I thought the Blu-ray that just came out, they finally got it right.
Did they? Because I know the old Blu-ray they didn't. Yeah,
I thought there was like a new one that came out. I could be wrong.
Oh, I'll check it because they decided it wasn't going to be impactful on home video. So, right.
Thank you. I got
dinosaurs.
Nice.
Ooh,
I love dinosaurs.
I love dinosaurs.
You love dinosaurs. I love dinosaurs.
Heck
big
yeah.
Dinosaur fan. And I this is like BBC, which I don't know. I've never seen this, but
that was a big deal when it aired. I remember everyone's like, oh my god, CG dinosaurs.
CG is sort of
Well, is it
at the time it was cool.
Yeah.
So, Plimtoons.
Ooh, nice.
A bunch of these on Laser, but like, I think this might be like all of them in one place.
Very cool.
It's not sure, but this looked cool. There's some really good ones.
Jeez. Yeah, those are intense.
I have to grab freaking Best in Show.
Oh,
good snapper.
Yeah. I have like no snappers, so I was.
Yep. Busy
bee. I'm getting more into DVD. I'm pretty sure Seth sent me this.
Yes, I did.
And I freaking refound this.
Wow.
It had been missing literally since I moved and since you like sent it to me. Like, I don't know where it went, and it was in some magical DVD box. And so it's been refound and rediscovered. Great.
Good job.
It has the ye old Laserdisc shop.
Yes. So
that's why I thought about you.
Yep. Cool. I have not seen anything from that, so I was excited.
Yeah.
Nice.
Another one that was like really should have been Laserdisc.
Haller just watched that today for the first time.
I was going to say, right? Yeah.
No, that's cool.
Yeah. And that's cool.
Yeah.
did Haller like it? Or did
he loved it.
Oh my gosh.
That's surprising.
I know. He's finicky.
I really feel like I don't know what he likes.
Oh, that's a classic.
Is this the good one? I was hoping this might be the good one.
That packaging is great.
Virgins.
Yeah.
And like, I just, this one looked really cool.
Yeah, that's awesome.
That's in Scarface for like male who never grows up.
That's
me. That's where you have the young time go and they die the young time go.
It's true.
Good point.
Just in case you know.
Thank you. I like that.
Oh, nice. Volume 2?
I'm going to try and get some more Crips, but
yeah,
this was at least by itself. Complete second season.
Yeah, they're all good. The only problem is like there's a bunch of Rotters out there, so you gotta watch out.
Rotter DVDs?
There's
a German Blu-ray of all of them. Yeah.
They did repress a bunch in Mexico, and those are really good. So
okay, I'll keep eyes out.
Yeah, if you see any Mexican stuff on there made in Mexico on the wrapper, then you're gold.
Good to know. Glad I'm finding this out.
Yeah.
And then
yes.
When?
Best musical of all time.
I mean, it's so good.
Yeah,
that wasn't a snapper from the get-go, right?
No, that's the original press. Yeah.
Yeah. I think we had a snapper over here of that
one. Did Warner get it over there, maybe? Or
because it was Paramount DVD. That's crazy.
Yeah.
I could be wrong, but
that DVD sold lots of copies.
I bought that the day it came out from Circuit City or wherever.
Which we got
That's nice. The documentary.
Yeah. I there was a bunch of these like PBS ones. And I was just, the 60s one seemed cool. And then Amadeus is the last one.
Oh, with the little digipack thing there.
Yeah. I guess this is a slip cover?
Slides out, yeah.
Yeah, it looks
like. Sam knows the slip covers.
Yeah, Warner did a lot of those. They did one for Unforgiven. Anything that won an award got that treatment.
I mean, I love this movie. I was kind of interested to see how I could watch it on my most minuscule TV that has a built-in DVD player and see how it looked. So,
yeah.
My tiny little DVD TV that I have in my kitchen, it's just like, it supposedly is like DTS or it has built-in speakers, but I just can't even imagine.
You need 5.1 in the kitchen.
Oh, hilarious. Yeah. It's the smallest TV.
Subwoofer under the sink.
That's so incredible. But I'm actually prepared for this segment.
Good job. What about Seth? What do you got? Anything?
Yeah, I've got something. Yeah, I was gonna confirm it was a snapper case over here. So I have a toy that I bought.
What? What'd you get?
Oh,
is it a Muppet?
Almost.
Who is it?
Lego set.
Wow.
Nice.
Wow.
Yeah,
it's got like
your Sesame Street.
Yeah,
who's that?
That's awesome.
Elmo.
Yeah.
Super cool.
So see, Oscar Lego geeks are buying this and removing all the Sesame references because they can put like brownstones in their Lego cities.
Yeah, so, and you can use it to play D&D. Yeah, use it.
That's awesome.
I thought I'm gonna save this until my daughter is the right age for us to build together, but then that's a long time.
18 plus. Wow.
Yeah, but with parental supervision, maybe a little lower.
Yeah, it's super detailed.
Oh, there's
so much cool stuff in it. Yeah, it was on sale at the brick and mortar store down at the local mall, so I got it, and my friend was there who's a Lego geek, and he didn't persuade me not to get it.
It's got Hoopers too over there on the side. It's like,
and there's like rumors now there's going to be an expansion set to it, so
it's pretty good to own to own, buy to own, or what it's called.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool. So, yeah. Oh, Cookie Monster has, and they, every person has like a little thing. They have like little stuff.
Oh, yeah.
It's impressive.
And I have Grover. I was going to ask if he was still.
Yeah, we're Snuffy. No,
there's no Snuffy, no Grover. So, yeah.
It's not in the trash can. It's on the front.
That's Oscar.
Yeah.
It's Oscar. Oh, my gosh. Sorry. Yeah. Sorry. It's been a while since I've watched.
And the count's there on a photograph in the apartment or something.
He must be on a clock, right?
Yeah. That would be perfect.
Yeah.
And they have the original Mr. Hooper as a sketch, which is kind of cute, which is like a very special episode where you
do
drawing of him. Yeah. Really fun toy. I have two Lego sets. I have Yellow Submarine and this one.
Wow.
That's fun.
Like any DVDs or Blu-rays or anything or no?
Oh, I got some stuff coming in the mail in a while.
Dang mail.
Yep.
Yeah. All right. And also, is it illegal to post in LDF about stuff that's coming in the mail? Is that like a new rule that was recently imposed?
Well, I mean, we frown upon it, but
I'm pretty sure I added the "no something's coming" to the rules because we're getting the I won something on eBay. Yep. It's coming. Yep. Oh, hey, I got it. And then, by the way, I'm now watching it. Like,
yes. We're
posting. And now I'm selling it.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Win the spin.
The win the spin. Yeah.
I don't need to know that you know how to use eBay. So do the rest of us.
The unboxing.
It gets here and it isn't broken. Yeah. Otherwise, or you're watching it. Otherwise,
no. I think that's a really good rule. And then we don't have to have people complaining about it and then being called D-lips.
Yeah. Like the next guest, Luke, do you got any pickups?
Hello, Ren wants to go first.
Okay, what do you got?
Okay, what did you get?
I got Spider-Man toothbrush.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Oh, sweet.
So cool. Yeah.
Is it electric? Does it? And then no, all right.
This one.
Yay.
Ah,
Raphael.
Nice. And this ninja turtle can even move.
Ooh, oh my goodness. Look at him. Mm-hmm.
That's great.
Are you new, or are you... He's a VIP move.
Oh, we're going to dance then. So much fun. Okay.
Your turn.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.
Okay.
Good job.
Fun. Thank you.
Bye.
Okay. Mama's at the grocery store, so.
All right.
I like her pickup. All right.
I got a few records.
Yeah, you're fired.
That'd be good, yeah.
Yep.
That's her quality.
I just came home. I got this one in Japan. I don't think I talked about it. If I did, I want to talk about it a little bit more. I got this guy. It's called the Aero Van, the Aero Bonds. Hmm. It's an unreleased 69 LP by this heavily Beatles influenced and young US trio who went to England and cut this album in the legendary Abbey Road studio.
Whoa.
So they made this album like in Abbey Road while the Beatles were there, you know, recording Abbey Road, but it never came out.
It like just stalled. Okay.
Anyway, so this is like a bootleg of 200 or something. Pretty good. I was listening to it today.
Huh.
Oh, they're there on the back. They're from like Missouri or something crazy.
So they had to like actually go out of their way to go to Abbey Road to rock star dream. Yeah.
But they were on the label. Like they got accepted, you know, and they came to Abbey Road to record it. Anyway, hold on, I'm close to
record. Were they on the Apple label or was it on
That's what I was wondering.
Yeah,
I'm not sure. I think it says it in the. I don't think they were on the Apple label.
Huh.
But it was produced by one of the same guys.
Not George Martin, obviously, but
no.
Parsons was the engineer.
Maybe Alan.
Yeah, well, could be.
I think they're at EMI. No, they loved us.
Okay.
You know what? You guys can look it up. You can figure it out. You're smart people.
Totally. I'll add some text over.
There you go. There was one producer that I think like even played on an album. It's pretty good. It sounds, you know, very much like the Beatles.
Sure.
Yeah, it's pretty good. All right. I picked up this one. I don't know if you guys know this band. I don't think you do. Guided by Voices. They re-released their original LP on clear wax. They are very lo-fi. They were when they first came out. And I mean, just like guys in their basement making kind of rock music. And they've since become very big.
I mean, not huge, but they have a very, very large following.
They've made,
they're over 100 albums in now. Like, they're just very prolific. But this one just came out, and that's fun.
Yeah, cool.
I doubt any of you will care at all, but I was at the record store, and this all came about because they said, oh, hey, I know you like this band. We got, like, a bunch of their original albums. It just, we happened to go to somebody's house, and they said they had a bunch of records, and they said, oh, well, I've got these too. And it was just like, holy crap. Like, this original, like, they were friends of the band in Ohio back in the day or whatever. And so this is the very first one they ever put out, called Forever Since Breakfast. I mean, it's pretty rare. And I paid too much for it because it's not that great. But it was like very REM, you know, it's like 84, 86, something like that. And this was before they were super lo-fi. They were trying to be something they weren't. But I've always, you know, I always thought, like, if I ever find this record, I'm gonna buy this record. And so I did.
There you go. Cool.
Last one I got. I got this today. And this is the original. The replacement. Sorry, Ma, forgot to take out the trash. This is, I guess, it's supposedly on brown vinyl. But it's like that root beer brown, you know, from back in the day, where it's pretty dark. But if you
can't really tell, light, yeah.
Oh, yeah, you can see it in the reflection.
I like that the cover says "File under Power Trash." that's it, man. That's all I got.
Pretty cool.
How did the how was the discussion about the Palma? Like, that's
it was fun.
What was the best one?
I mean, Snake Eyes, obviously, but
okay. Yeah. What was really the best one? Seth, what was the best one?
Yeah, but there's so many. There's some that are good. Blowout, I think, is pretty good. Sisters is good. Final Paradise is good. Greetings. In some way.
Like, yeah, I can't. You're all talking at the same time.
Greetings was Ryan's favorite.
Yep, Greetings in all movies.
What?
He's being facetious.
Really good. It had a really, you know.
Okay, Seth, what was your favorite? Since this is kind of your thing. I love Sisters. I love Body Double.
Yeah.
Like those are my two favorites.
You loved Body Double.
I loved it. I thought it was so uncomfortable and just that weird blue velvet kind of way. And it was like this weird 80s. And then that first shot, like, it's all normal until he is looking through the binoculars at the girl, right? And it's like, oh, this is going to be one of those weird movies. Okay.
And that music, man. Yeah. Love that music.
Yeah.
I like
Blowout.
I like Blowout, Sisters. But also I feel like Snake Eyes is where I think he rips off Hitchcock too much, but then in Snake Eyes it works. It sort of becomes a whole thing. Then they have like the outliers, like the one with De Niro and the baseball bat.
Untouchables
and they're sort of like goes into different direction. Then it goes back to the De Palma Hitchcock Faw thing. Yep. But I feel it works best in Sisters. It works really great, and it also works great in Snake Eyes.
Okay, I'll have to rewatch. I remember liking Snake Eyes in the movie theater. I need to rewatch it. I have the VHS, so I can watch now.
It's just a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Cool. What's your favorite, Luke?
Oh, I didn't watch as many as you guys did. I didn't feel like watching them all. But yeah. Oh, how was Phantom of Paradise?
That movie rules.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Does it really? Or
check
it
out. That's cool.
For real. Crushes. Yeah, crushes
Blu-ray. Do you see a lot of Paul Williams? Like, or is he mostly Madison?
Yeah. Oh yeah. No, he's in it.
Oh great. Yeah. I mean, he's the Phantom, right? He's the
No.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Smart. Yeah, he's a different dude. Yep.
Okay.
He's like a main dude. So you're gonna love it.
Check it out.
Yeah. I like how everything, like the doorways are all short for him.
Yeah.
And then everyone else character has to duck.
Like duck down, yeah.
Duck into his areas because everything was built for his size.
So was any of the Japanese copies, Luke? Or
I had one. I don't know where it is. I think I sold it. It was pretty cool. It has a different cover. It's nice.
The covers are great.
Yeah.
So I really Paul Williams, I really like his documentary called Still Alive. I don't know. I think I watched in a hotel room once and I just really liked it. But they talk about how Phantom, you know, bombed everywhere but like one place, one city in Canada, like just loved it. And they went back to, you know, had a screening there and it sold out and everything. But yeah.
Yeah, that was big growing up. Everyone in my house liked it. We decided that moms hate Dressed to Kill. That's,
yes.
And grandmas don't like that either. But yeah, my parents.
Grandmas, yeah.
They approve of Phantom of the Paradise, though.
Yeah.
You know what? How about we just talk about it again? You know, let's start from the very
beginning. Roll it back. So the first movie he did was Murder a la Mod. And then Greetings. Yeah. Yep. Greetings. Ryan's favorite.
Yep.
Yeah. All right.
And Sisters, come on, Sisters! That
opening, Sisters rocks.
Yeah,
it's just such a long intro, and like, oh, yeah. this is yeah, that knife, man, that birthday cake knife.
It's a lot of fun, yeah. it's just so weird, so much weird stuff going on in there.
I love the split screen is great. Yeah. And it's they hold it for so long.
Oh yeah, coming up the elevator,
yeah,
the guy's like in the hallway hiding from them, yeah.
And it just makes you start to think, like, how did he shoot that? Like, how did, I don't know, just, yeah.
And I've been around folding couches my whole life. I'm like, why wasn't I hiding bodies in them? That's like such a great idea.
I think we tried that as kids, and that no way would that really work. I don't know.
It actually did, because like they did that for the movie, like they proved it worked, because
in the movie,
we're going to do this. We're going to prove it works. And it did.
And then in Jurassic Park, there's real dinosaurs because we saw it in the movie.
Yeah.
Well, you see, Hollywood money. Can do
whatever you want. Rumor has it that couch is still out there somewhere in Canada. Charles Durning's still on a pole staring at it.
Gotta watch.
Someday.
I was going to say that one of the only things that we didn't talk about Brian De Palma wise, like with his shots, like obviously he does those like long shots and the spinning shots. We didn't really talk so much about the spinning shots.
Okay.
The other one that is that he's got the person here and the person here.
Yeah, the split focus. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's an owl. It's like John Travolta and an owl.
Yeah, the De Palma-ism,
Yeah.
That's like the last one we kind of didn't, because he does that a lot. Obviously, the split screen we talked about.
But yeah, that's up there.
So I've watched Blowout, and I'm such a fan of the conversation that I just could not get into Blowout. Anyway.
I think the ending is a bit over the top in Blowout. So there's like these huge fireworks thing and like, but
it's supposed to be.
Yeah. I know, but it's cool.
The conversation is a great movie. Coppola.
Coppola.
Hat trick there, with Godfather, Godfather 2, and Conversation.
Hold on.
And then Apocalypse. So it's 4 in a row, right?
Yeah, he was crushing it.
Yeah. Then he didn't crush it.
Yeah, then it was Cotton Club and a bunch of crap.
Was that not? I haven't seen that. I've never even heard anybody talk about Cotton Club.
Yeah, it's
Rumblefish.
Pretty. Like, true. He had Rumblefish and then back to back Outsiders and Rumblefish. He was like full S.E. Hinton mode.
Is that what is that Blowout?
What do you got there?
Yeah, it's a Japanese.
Wow.
That's really cool. Interesting layout.
Oh, that's called Midnight something. It's not called Blowout. Midnight Cross.
I mean, that really, I don't know who did it better there. I think it's still a toss up here.
Neither I don't know. Doing U.S. it. Got the modeled gloss problem there.
You guys talk about Blow Up. Is it?
Spice? We did mention that. Yeah,
okay. That's one of my favorites.
Yeah.
Hot Topic. Did you guys talk about the? I thought Vinny's topic about backwards Laserdisc rentals. Did you see that post? I thought that was interesting.
No, we didn't.
I sent him the one Raging Bull that was a Laserdisc rental.
Oh, and the image was flipped, right? The
image was flipped. And so I started looking, and I couldn't find any others. I've got actually two body doubles.
It's the same, yeah.
Yeah. My eraser head is the same.
Yeah.
I got the regular bunny double. The white screen.
Yep. Is it rotted?
I haven't tried it yet.
Yeah.
And of course, I've got my Spider-Man team.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
A good pickup.
Yeah, is the Japanese body double widescreen?
Is that a Japanese
Spider-Man 2 toothbrush? It is. It is a Japanese.
It's a Spider-Man.
It's a late release toothbrush.
No Obi?
No. These are not. This is just the regular American one.
Oh, yeah. That's just Jabroni. Yep.
This is the Laserdisc.
A permanent rental. Obi?
Ooh.
Oh yeah, perm Obi.
Oh, fun.
Oh, Obi. Permanent Obi.
Nice. All right. So you ready for the non-LD recommendations?
Yep.
All right, cool. Let's do it. I got two. Just because Netflix is dying and you're supposed to hate on it, I'm still watching it. So I finally finished All of Us Are Dead, which is a Korean teen high school zombie movie or series.
All right.
It's funny. I had watched like the first six episodes. I'm like, oh, this is winding down. This is almost done. Nope. They threw like a twist in there. It's almost like two seasons crammed into one. There's like another six episodes. So it is a lot of zombies going on in there. So yeah, I just finished that. That was a lot of fun. So, so yeah, if you like teen high school movies, yeah. Is she going to date that guy or is she going to date that guy? Or are they going to turn into zombies? Yeah.
Wow. All right.
That kind of thing.
You sold me on it.
Yeah. It's pretty fun. But I mean, it does, it mixes it up. There's some smart zombies that show up partially through it. No spoilers, but yeah. Yeah. Stirs the pot. But the other big thing, I'd been dying for this to come out and it finally did on HBO Max. The Tony Hawk documentary, Until the Wheels Fall Off.
Yes.
So great. You know, it shows... there was all this footage of him. It's like this little scrawny kid, and it's just so cool. Like going through the old days when like Stacy Peralta was coming down and trying to build up the Bones Brigade guys. It's like this lightning in a bottle moment. Like all the most iconic skaters of all time, hanging out, and of course they're all still around, interviewed in here. Yeah, you got Christian Hosoi also in here, and Rodney Mullins, of course, in there, and all the Bones Brigade guys, and. So great. Yeah. And you get to see his rise up and just all the obstacles. And, you know, I never realized how much everyone hated his dad. Cause I just remember when I was into skating, like Tony Hawk's dad helped him build his ramp at his house. And you're like, cool. But like back in the day, he was like orchestrating a lot of the events and he was like the tough guy with the clipboard that was like, you know, quit screwing around, kids. So yeah, I didn't realize like people were like, oh, well, obviously he's winning. Cause your dad is on the, you know, the board or whatever. So they're so the poor kid had to like really prove himself. So it's badass. That dude is obsessed. It's cool. So I definitely recommend it. Great soundtrack too. Oingo Boingo over the end credits. Devo, The Clash, lots of great stuff.
Got good taste.
Yeah. So definitely
let's be serious.
Yeah, I mean, it's so cool. Like, you're like, all right, well, he's up here, and then it's all over at the end of the 80s. But nope, it's like ESPN stuff happens again. The video games drop. It's like, Jesus, like, what a like perfect career. Like,
oh my God. I know, and he was in The New Guy? That still just blows my mind.
Yeah. Oh, man. So, yeah, definitely check out the Tony Hawk documentary, and you'll love it. That's my recommendation. What do you got, Ryan?
I watched Talons of the Eagle.
Yes.
This is just, there's so much Billy Blanks in here. No shirt.
Who's the other guy?
Who cares?
Lyle Murray.
Oh, yeah.
And then you've got Matthias Hughes.
Oh.
Always a staple. And what's his name? James Hong.
Oh. Oh, James Hong is a legend.
Yeah, yeah. So check that out.
Legit.
And then I've been binging What We Do in the Shadows, which is just fantastic.
Nice.
So I should be finishing season 3 in another week or so.
Is that the newest one?
Yes. And then apparently season 4 has been filmed, so it should be coming soon.
Okay. Nice. What's is that Hulu or Poopy or?
Hulu.
Poopies.
Doo-doo?
That's Hulu.
That's Hulu. Yeah.
It's on FX, I believe, originally.
Oh, yeah. For you cable subscribers. Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
For those of you non-cord cutters.
Yeah.
There's like 6 of you out there, your grandparents, maybe.
Yeah.
My grandma, yeah.
See?
There you go. She'll like it.
She'll my light.
Yeah. All right. Is that it?
Yep.
All right, cool. What do you got, Max? You got any recommendations?
Well, tonight is the last friggin' season finale episode of RuPaul's Drag Race, so I've
been watching a lot of that.
But I'm trying to think like what I've even been watching. Mainly that, and then I've been watching a lot of the Mike Matei on YouTube. Mm-hmm. Just watching a lot of just like the Roger Rabbit ones, or like he did a lot of Bart Simpson playthroughs of things.
And, oh, all right.
Yeah. Just nice to hear someone else screaming about video games and I don't have to play.
Yeah, you can just chill out and watch. Yeah.
I feel like I'm playing it, you know. Yeah. I'm just watching, it feels vicarious, you know.
Yeah. I mean, when those Let's Plays first came out, everyone's like, well, this is stupid. Nobody's ever gonna watch this. And come to find out, Yeah, everybody's going to watch it.
And I like that he asks the chat of people who also played, and then they give him hints or things like,
yeah.
I don't know. It's ingenious. I really like that.
Nice.
All right.
You got anything, Seth? What do you recommend?
Yeah, sure. I've been watching on Apple TV Plus, you know, the streaming service that nobody has.
Except for Vinny. Apple. And he yells at us all the time about it.
It's funny. I had a free trial for like 3 months and I didn't even turn it on once.
Yeah, my parents did Ted Lasso because they had that too.
Yeah, that's what people do. They don't even use it. It's too bad. They have, I think they actually have the highest quality bit rate when it comes to like Blu-ray quality, Blu-ray bit rate level for the 4K stuff. So it's not that, but they have pretty high bit rate. But I'm watching the Severance show. I really enjoyed that one.
Mm.
Yeah, it's a Ben Stiller show. It's the concept is there's a office. When you take the elevator down, there's a chip in your brain that severs your work life from your personal life. So when you hit the office, you don't remember anything from the outside and vice versa.
Whoa.
The show is really cool. It has like, you know, Charlie Kaufman sort of vibe. You know, what's the French guy that did his movies? The Jim Carrey one, this Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, sort of that sort of
film. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah. And also because it's like the corporation is a bit weird. You don't know much about it, a bit mysterious. So it's a bit of like a Lost when they're in the shaft. They're finding out, they're watching like these weird information videos that are like on VHS or like disc and stuff like that. It's a bit weird. And yeah, it's good. It's really cool.
I've only seen the video.
Its name?
Severance, right?
Severance, yeah. Okay. So it's got...
Yeah. I said there's that great video where they took this new song from the Swedish death metal band Meshuggah, and they put it over the scene where the guy puts a record on the record player in the room, and they're all dancing to it.
Yeah, yeah.
I highly recommend. I think it's called Your Coworker Hates Meshuggah. So, but there's crazy flashing lights in the ceiling in the room, and
pretty wild. So the employees get like, because they're basically they don't know what's a good reward when they like hit their monthly quota, so they get like, ooh, I got Chinese finger traps. Ooh, I get treated to waffle night. They eat like two Belgian waffles. And they're basically slaves. And they sort of speculate how they are on the outside. And it's really weird. And it's, there's a great cast. Patricia Arquette, John Turturro, which already looks just the same as it does in the Batman movie. So that's a bit weird. And who else? It's Christopher Walken, isn't it? So... what else? And this Mark Scott guy. He's been in a couple of small things. I've seen him in like...
Yeah, the Step Brothers guy's in it. Adam Scott's in it, right?
Yeah. Adam Scott, yeah.
He was dancing in the scene I saw.
Oh, yeah. So the Catalina Wine Festival.
He's fucking Catalina Wine Mixer.
Catalina Wine Mixer.
Yeah.
Strictly that's 80s Joel.
That's the guy. Okay, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Singing Sweet really Child of Mine.
It's
pissed off about the pitch.
So good.
So all episodes are out. So get like a month, watch it, and then drop. And you don't need an Apple product to watch it. So
get Vinny's password.
Yeah,
you can get my password. Okay, that's fine.
We'll talk off camera.
Yeah.
Then I also watched a show called We Crash on the same server, same service. It's about some sort of company that does like office sharing with Jared Leto, and they're like overspending and tanking and stuff.
Is that based on WeWork or whatever it is?
Yeah, based on WeWork. Yeah, it's great. Decent, and it's Jared Leto with makeup and fake teeth and stuff to look like some Israeli guy, and does like an accent. It's okay. It's nothing great.
Is he full method acting?
Yeah,
most likely he's probably he didn't eat bacon for that entire he's really and also I watched on HBO Max, so I checked right now during when you talked about the Tony Hawk. We get like stuff all right away, which is so great. Otherwise I have to use a VPN and stuff, so that's but I watched a documentary about Bob Einstein on HBO Max that was quite enjoyable. He was Super Dave.
Yes.
Yeah. Super Dave. And he's also the brother of Albert Brooks. So I guess why now I understand why he changed his last name, because it would be the director Albert Einstein. That would probably be a bit weird. Yeah, and so that was interesting to see him. So I only knew him from the Curb Your Enthusiasm thing. And that was a pretty good documentary.
I should watch that. Like back in the 70s, Super Dave Osborne was like on every, seemed like every variety show. Yeah, so yeah. It was great.
And I have to, yeah, and I wonder if there's a like DVD or something with his stuff, because it's like Looney Tunes humor, but with, you know, a regular guy.
Yeah.
Live action Looney Tunes humor. Like,
yeah, there's got to be like a DVD compilation or something.
And like, you know, him being compressed and there's just his helmet and like little feet and stuff like that.
Yeah. Yeah. I know. It's, yeah, super, super goofy. Yeah. Cool.
But yeah, I think that's it.
Luke, you got anything? Oh, wait, what's Max got?
Sorry. I was going to say, I totally remembered something I wanted to tell you guys that I saw. And I'd like, this was like deep YouTube. Like, I don't know who the hell is watching it. This was like a freaking, so I've been watching all these biker shows where they're like building bikes, like the OCC, Orange County Choppers type of thing. And this is like this sub show, like possibly before Orange County Choppers. It's called Biker Build Off, where they would put these like, you know, celebrity bikers of the time, right? And they've just hyped these people to like the end all be all.
Yeah.
And they just, for no apparent reason, did this huge Oscars style award show for the 24 guys involved in this freaking biker build off. And they did it at like Hard Rock Vegas, and none other than freaking like a rest, they have a pro wrestler freaking hosting the show.
Wow.
And like, it's just, it's Bill Goldberg hosting a freaking Oscar show with this other woman. And then they have like the guy who does all the voiceover acting in person, like dressed in biker gear. And it was the most bizarre thing I have ever seen.
They went like, all out.
They went all out. The way that they announced, like, instead of opening an envelope, they broke a beer bottle and then pulled the paper out. This was insanity. And no one knew what was going on. And they were treating this like this was going to be some huge thing that they were going to routinely do every year after the season of Biker.
Yeah, there should be like season 20 out now, but
there's not a single another one.
I wonder if it even aired. If it was, I think
it must have aired. It was. Yeah. It's the strangest thing. And I was like, it's freaking Bill Goldberg though.
Wow.
And he's not like in his element at all, like hosting this. He's not landing jokes.
Because he can be funny.
He can be funny. These jokes that they wrote for him that he's clearly reading from a teleprompter did not land.
And it was so good.
It was almost more funny because you're just like, and everyone that walks up to try and accept this, and the award is a belt buckle.
Well, yeah.
It's a biker,
just a regular
belt, big old silver belt buckle.
Okay.
And like, it's just insanity. And I just was like, I'm so glad that I saw this because I've seen all of these biker build off things. It's very, very like early Discovery Channel.
These are from. Okay.
And it's like, it's so bizarre. But they're like, I mean, it was crazy. I had to share.
Well, I hope they have another Oscar whatever party someday. Right.
It's literally like, it's like the chop. I don't even know what they called it. It was
the most, choppers.
It's just ridiculous.
How you gonna top that, Luke?
One question. So
you're not
County, the Orange County chopper people, is that the one that I made the meme with the yes. AR where okay, good.
That's the meme, yeah.
They're stretching it.
Yeah.
I like it that way.
Actually, yeah, let me put that up for the kids
at home. See the
meme. All right, now what you watching, Luke?
Anchor.
Just real quick.
Yeah, sorry. That was enough time. See you later.
We've run out of space to record. Yeah,
out of hard drive's full. The cloud is completely bad.
The Aerovons, the band I was telling about from St. Louis, Missouri, they were on EMI. The album was engineered by Beatles engineer Norman Smith, Jeff Emmerich, Bill McDonald, and Alan Parsons, who also played recorder on one of the album's tracks.
Nice.
Also, this was like a test press. It didn't come out like officially until 2003. Oh. This record is like a Swedish bootleg.
Oh.
So it came out of Sweden. Nice. And found it at a weird hard off just way out of the way that it shouldn't have been there. I was like, oh, this is very out of place. Sure. What the fuck? I'll get it.
Yeah.
What I've been watching. I know I really want to watch the new season of Russian Doll. I don't know if you've seen Russian Doll season one.
Yes.
Amazing. Loved it.
Yeah. It just came out, right?
Yeah, I guess she goes back in time in this one, back to the 80s or something. Oh. But, you know, the first one is all about, you know, it's your standard repeat day, but they did it so well, like just that. So amazing. And the music was great. Like it introduced me to new bands. Like I looked into stuff they played on the soundtrack. So yeah, really looking forward to that. Probably won't be as good as first season, but whatever, you know. Richard Linklater just put a new movie out called Apollo 10 and a Half on Netflix. I tried watching it last night, fell asleep. So that's cool.
Good review.
I'm super excited about that. I don't know if I'll finish it.
Is that one rotoscope animated too or no?
It is, yes.
It is. Okay.
So
Vinny hates that for some reason.
Well, Vinny hates a lot of things. So
yeah, he hates animation. Yeah, so good point.
I think that's it. I can't think of anything else. I haven't really watched anything yet.
All right, so who's going to record store day tomorrow?
Ooh. You gonna get me my box set so I don't have to go out? That'd be great.
Which one you need?
I'm gonna get all of the Taylor Swifts and that's it.
You son of a bitch. Yep. How does that work? So how is that gonna so if you're in line, so you're gonna be if you're first in line, do they just open the doors and just say go at it? Or it's like okay, you can walk through the line first?
It's my different place, stores they let, do different things.
How yeah, my place they go? Let waves of people in.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So there'll be like a couple people in or five people. And then there's a guy at the door usually who keeps an eye as people step away from the feeding trough area. He'll start letting in another group of two and like that. Yeah.
Most of them cap like the amount of people in the store at any time. So it's not a madhouse. They like some of them you can get like one of as many as you want. Some you can only get like five, but you can't get like two of anything. Like they all, most of them are like you can't buy like three of the most like but it just depends on the store. Mm-hmm. But it's gonna be dumb because there's you take a thing that's already like very sought after like in general and that's limited edition records on a day where everybody's trying to get the same records and then add in teenage girls. Great call. that's what this hobby needed.
Yeah, how many of those records were made? Like 10,000 or something? Yeah.
Less than like some of the bigger things that I've seen over the years.
Yeah.
And it's something that you add in a bunch of rabid teenage girls.
And is it new stuff? Is it like a new little EP?
There's like something? I want to say that like one of the two cuts of the song is like different. So you got to have it. Otherwise,
Didn't she just like re-record a bunch of stuff too? Like, to get her rights back? Yeah.
Yeah, that's the, that's what I was going to say.
Taylor, what are you getting? What are you looking for?
I want Motorhead Lost Tapes, Volume 2. I want to get
where they just sing Ace of Spades over and over.
Yep, again? It's just that all Ace of Spades.
All the different cuts of Ace of Spades.
Yep,
yeah. they do the whole deck.
Yep, all of them. Yep, the Jack of Clubs. Then I want the Gojira live album and maybe Dillinger Escape Plan album, and there's another Opeth's reissue of My Arms Your Hearse I want to get really really bad. And shout out to Stockholm, Sweden.
Yeah.
Michael Okerfeldt. And
do they have record store day in Sweden? Oh, they do. That you showed them.
Yeah, we have tomorrow. I didn't know because I know there's like one, two in the US or something. So there's one tomorrow, I guess.
And there was like five of them last year.
Just one this year until the pressing plants couldn't meet the demand. So now there's a June drop.
Well, there was already a June one, but like I think it was they knew some was going to be late. But they basically saved it because they knew that like more than what was initially announced was not going to be on time.
Yeah.
So yeah.
So it's like, one Voivod album's out tomorrow and then like one's out in June. Yep. And the Peter Gabriel album I want is out in June. So
yeah.
Yeah. And for my wife, I'm going to probably look for the Replacements live album, the Nick Cave live album and the Stevie Nicks Belladonna reissue.
I like her taste.
Yeah, she gets a pass. Yep. Nice.
So you have the Blue Velvet soundtrack
coming out. Oh, yeah, that's on my list.
Yep. Alice Cooper's Brutal Planet. The Doors have a LA Woman making of type thing where it's like four vinyl records. It's got like all these like B-side cuts. I think they want to like kind of do their own Beatles making of thing, but not near as cool, but still. Yeah. The Offspring have Greatest Hits coming out. Apparently they've been around long enough for that. Wow. And it's like a color variant because of course Foo Fighters have 45 and then I'm going to get all the Taylor Swifts. Like, I'm going to go to every town and get them before everyone else can.
Because I'm a trash person.
Yeah. I might get the Alice in Chains EP too.
Yeah, that one there's like 24,000 of. That's the most I've ever seen. So like, they were like, it's going to be limited, but not so limited that like, you know, you have to fight the Swifties.
Yeah. So. I'm tempted for the Ramones box as well, because that's pretty cool. But
it's very cool.
Yeah.
It's also, you know, $200.
Yeah, it's a little pricey, but it's all their like 80s stuff, like leading up to what? Does it tap out at?
Six albums from the 80s, and then like B-sides for the seventh vinyl, which is really awesome.
But it's pretty cool,
You know,
yeah,
you can buy a lot of late releases for that. I mean, and you can't get late releases on any other format, so like, why even try?
VHS late releases.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Not the same as, you know.
The only thing I'm looking for, the box set I'm looking for, I like a saxophone player called Albert Eiler. He died in like 1972. He was found in a ditch, but he's an amazing saxophone player. They're going to put out a big old box set of like his later recording, a live later recording. It was never released, so look forward to that. Yeah, he's like Albert Eiler. It was Albert Eiler, Coltrane, and Pharoah Sanders were the three big, you know. They're great.
And Taylor Swift.
And of course. And then Taylor Swift. And Swift, Motorhead. Ace of Spades.
Yeah. Gotta get that. So Seth, your local record store has a Laserdisc on display, right?
Yeah. They put up the Pink Floyd disc. The ACV version, And they wrote a hyphen. But he said he's going to get a collection in soon. So he's going to call me. So I helped him with, this one shouldn't be that much. And I helped him with pricing a bit because he was a bit low and I felt sorry for him and I didn't need it. So therefore I helped him.
Nice.
Did you talk about the Iron Giant kid? You talk about that?
No, we didn't.
There's been a lot of hot topics. You
know? There's a lot of Iron Giant. Yeah, we did have a lot of hot topics. The Golden Ticket obviously took up a lot of time. So.
The Iron Giant kid was, I liked him. He just said, hey, my buddy gave me a bunch of Laserdiscs. And he just pulled
just happened to have this.
Look at this one. It's pretty common. I love this movie.
That was pretty cool. Yeah.
How much?
And everyone's like, oh my God.
Anyway, that's it. I told them, like, hey, buddy, this is easily worth, few hundred dollars.
Yeah. Don't let these jabronis.
Yeah.
Well, I'll give you $5 for it.
Yeah.
Then I'll flip it.
Terrible.
In front of you.
Yeah. We talked about that one.
You talk about that one?
Yeah, we did. Yeah.
In Toy
Story. He said, I donated them. Get out of here. You didn't.
Yeah, he was like, it was a typo. I gave them to my buddy.
Oh, I didn't realize I had two copies of these. Uh-huh. Yeah, I got two copies of Dirty Work and, all the other late releases.
Going to my friend, going to a good home. So, Well,
it'll be on eBay tomorrow if it's not already. I bet if I look on eBay right now, it's on there.
I have this thing with, in Toy Story 2, where the guy that's the toy dealer, he sees a Woody toy and he picks up a bunch of other stuff. So, I'll take this junk for.
Car guys would do that too. They'd come to rev up your engine really loud and be like, oh, listen to that. Oh, that's not good. That's, it's going to fall apart down the street.
It's funny.
Alternator's going out.
I'm going to a car show tomorrow.
Oh, you're going to pull that? You're
going to. Well, I'm taking my car.
Oh, okay.
Car show.
Nice. Yeah, how's your car doing?
It's doing. It's in the driveway.
All right, that's good. And it can leave the driveway.
You can leave the driveway. The gas is woo. And the engine is so
something else.
Certainly leaving that in the driveway and looking at it a lot.
Fair enough.
How much is a gallon?
Woo! Yeah, it's hot.
Sorry. Europe.
I can't say how much it is because the price will go up from when I say it now to when this airs. So.
Yeah, true.
Yeah. Are you using like 95 octane or what is it? Like?
No, it's
87.
87, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow, it goes that low?
Well,
that's like the standard over here. Yeah.
Jet fuel. I mean, what are we talking about here? Jesus.
How much is gas in Sweden right now? Yeah, it's
$8.
I calculate it's like it's a lot compared to you two.
Yeah.
I calculated because you have gallons that meet a lot of math.
Sure.
Yes, actually, that is a lot of math. Wow. Yeah.
And it's also it's 95 octane and even higher, 97, 98. Yeah.
Do you guys drive rockets? You're
driving jets.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's better, they say, or it's like it's a.
Well, yeah, that's not disputed here.
You put on Wile E. Coyote goggles and get in your jet.
And I have a Toyota Prius that I'm fueling up with 98.
What? This is ridiculous. Yes. I'm fueling my Toyota Prius with 87?
Yeah, everything's 87 here.
Wow.
Yeah.
Funny.
That's not Formula One fuel.
And they always tell you, like, this engine has been designed for cheap-ass jabroni gas. Don't put any fancy gas in it.
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah, don't waste your money.
Yeah.
You still have it.
I put the high-end stuff in the Chevy Volt there, and it worked. That's
high-test dick lips over here.
Yeah. But even that, I filled it up the other day, and it was $38 in the Chevy Volt because it's amazing. Yeah. So.
Look at you. All right, let's do final spins, or what's spinning next. I'm going to keep the De Palma thing going because I screwed up and I didn't finish. So I'm going to watch Bonfire of the Vanities in Seth's honor. Watch that next.
Yeah. Please.
Gridlock.
Yes. We need to watch
with the Tupac movie?
No, not a good movie.
No, not apostrophe D.
Not Gridlock.
That's not Tupac.
Oh, yeah, okay. But Hasselhoff does stab himself to try and get into a rehab facility in one scene. Yeah, just like in Gridlocked.
Wow.
What are you spending, Max?
I'm considering. I'm like looking at what I pulled out here. I may.
You got options.
I may get involved in this disorganized crime. Actually, I think this one piqued my interest enough.
Actually, yeah, that's got a cast.
Right. I mean, like it just looked good enough. To put that one on the top.
Alan Diamond Phillips, you can't go wrong.
Yeah. I mean, he's in the first power, so.
Yeah, but for real, I'm gonna. Now that you've said, I mean, I've gotten too many recommendations just now, so I'm definitely gonna watch the Tony Hawk. I didn't know.
Oh, yeah.
Yet.
You got HBO Max. You're good.
I got that. Yeah. Definitely gonna watch that, and definitely gonna check out the Russian Doll thing because, geez, I loved that first season.
Yep.
And then, man, there's a lot of good things.
And check out the Korean zombie drama.
Yes, that was the one I was thinking. I'm like,
yeah, All of Us Are Dead is the name of that.
Okay, cool. Yep. Yes. All of those sounded really interesting. So.
Yep. All right, Seth, what's your next spin?
Or watch? It's going to be some De Palma stuff. I don't know. Do I have any more discs with De Palma? Well, I'm going to continue watching them. I've been watching some streamed things and rented stuff. So it's going to be a hodgepodge, but I don't know. I've got Kalito's DDS. I'm going to watch that.
Oh, yeah.
And Scarface I don't have, but then I have the Untouchable Japanese release, I think. So we'll spin that one.
Have you seen Scarface before, Untouchables?
Untouchable, I've seen a lot when I was a kid, and Scarface I see parts of. I don't think I've seen the entire, but I've seen, like, you know, I know what's going on.
You've seen the big money shots.
It's so iconic, yeah. Yeah. You can't not see it.
Hello to My Little Friend and all those stuff, yeah.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to watch, like, some of the older De Palmas as well, because I've more or less gone through his filmography now, so I might as well continue.
Yeah, I should really check out those old De Niro films. I know Ryan highly recommends them.
I'm interested in that, too.
Yeah, because I haven't seen High Mom.
You know? I mean, I had watched this kind of, like step through just, like, a blurb about everything, just to kind of brush up on those ones that I didn't even have, so...
Yeah. Yeah, I forgot to mention too, like there's that documentary, which I really like. It's just called De Palma, and what Noah Baumbach did it with one of the other, Jake Paltrow, I think.
Mm.
And it's just De Palma sitting in a room talking about every movie like we did chronologically for like 2 hours. And it's freaking awesome. He's got a lot of great stories and it's cool. So
he was less time than we were, or you guys were, is that what you're saying?
No, we finished his filmography before he did because, we're awesome.
I mean, he had more movies that we didn't cover because they weren't on Laserdisc, but that's
good point. Yeah. Yeah, because they talked about Femme Fatale and everything in that. So I recommend that. What are you spending next, Luke? Or are you just going to eat some broccoli or something?
Dinner.
Laserdiscs.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah. DVDs.
Stuff. I got stuff around me. I'll watch.
All right.
You know, I live, love, learn, do all that.
Laugh.
Yeah. Sure.
Jeez. You're a sign at Kohl's, man.
Oh my God. You're Ray Dunn.
All right. Speaking of done, I think we're done.
Sweet. Yeah.
Thanks for hanging out, everybody. Ah, I should do like a cool split screen, like finale, yes. Like split focus.
I was going to say we should have like a really long beginning shot for our intro, and I'll just.
Oh, like, we should have you like going into the laser lair. Yeah.
And like Seth dressed as a woman.
Yes. Hiding behind the curtain.
Right behind you.
For all the moms.
Yeah, maybe I'll have an interview with my mom, yeah, to add to the end of this. So what do you think of the Palma?
Yes.
All right. Well, thanks for hanging out, everybody.
Thanks.
What a twist.